4, 3, 2, 1. Disclaimer. I do not own the rights to the images or information provided. This was strictly made for the purpose of studying for boards. Since there are so many videos and so few images, some of the videos will play prior to the case presentation. The vestibular system is the primary sensory system that maintains the animal's balance, its normal orientation relative to the gravitational field of the Earth. This orientation is maintained in the setting of linear or rotatory acceleration or deceleration or tilting of the animal. The vestibular system is responsible for maintaining the position of the eyes, neck, trunk, and limbs relative to the position or movement of the head at any time. Anatomy and physiology. Receptor. The receptor for special proprioception, SP, the vestibular system, develops in conjunction with the receptor for the auditory system, special somatic afferent system. They are derived from ectoderm but are contained in a mesodermally derived structure. Together, these receptors are the components of the inner ear. The ectodermal component arises as a proliferation of ectodermal epithelial cells on the surface of the embryo adjacent to the developing rhombencephalon. This structure is the otic placod, which subsequently invaginates to form an otic pit and otic vesicle, otocyst, that breaks away from its attachment to the surface ectoderm. This sacular structure undergoes extensive modification of its shape but always retains its fluid-filled lumen and surrounding thin epithelial wall as it becomes the membranous labyrinth of the inner ear. Special modifications of its epithelial surface at predetermined sites form the receptor organs for the vestibular and auditory systems. Corresponding developmental modifications occur in the surrounding periaxial mesoderm to provide a supporting capsule for the membranous labyrinth. This fluid-filled ossified structure is the bony labyrinth contained within the developing petrous portion of the temporal bone. These membranous and bony labyrinths are formed adjacent to the first and second branchial arches and their corresponding first pharyngeal pouch and first branchial groove. The first branchial groove gives rise to the external ear canal. The first pharyngeal pouch forms the auditory tube and the mucosa of the middle ear cavity. The intervening tissue forms the tympanum. The ear ossicles are derived from the neural crest of branchial arches 1, malleus and incus, and 2, stapes. These ossicles become components of the middle ear associated laterally with the tympanum, malleus, and medially with the vestibular window of the bony labyrinth of the inner ear, stapes. Anatomically, the bony labyrinth in the petrous part of the temporal bone consists of three continuous fluid-filled portions, figures 12-1 and 12-2. These areas are the large vestibule and the three semicircular canals and the cochlea, which arise from the vestibule. Dilation in one end of each of the bony semicircular canals is the ampulla. All three continuous bony components contain paralymph, a fluid similar to cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, from which it may be derived. In the bony labyrinth are two openings, the vestibular and cochlear windows, which are named according to the components of the bony labyrinth in which they are located. Each opening is covered by a membrane, and the stapes is inserted in the membrane that covers the vestibular window. The ectodermally derived membranous labyrinth consists of four fluid-filled compartments, all of which communicate. Figure 12-3, see also figures 12-1 and 12-2. These compartments are contained within the components of the bony labyrinth and include a saccule and utriculus within the bony vestibule, the three semicircular ducts within the bony semicircular canals, and a cochlear duct within the bony cochlea. The endolymph contained within the membranous labyrinth is thought to be derived from the blood vessels along one wall of the cochlear duct and is absorbed back into blood through the blood vessels surrounding the endolymphatic sac. The three semicircular ducts are the anterior, vertical, posterior, vertical, and lateral, horizontal. Each semicircular duct is oriented at right angles to the others. Thus, rotation of the head around any plane causes endolymph to flow within one or more of the ducts. Each semicircular duct connects at both ends with the utriculus, which, in turn, connects with the saccule by way of the intervening endolymphatic duct and sac. The saccule connects with the cochlea duct by the small ductus reunions. Crista ampullaris at one end of each membranous semicircular duct is a dilation called the ampulla. On one side of the membranous ampulla, a proliferation of connective tissue forms a transverse ridge called the crista. See figures 12-1 through 12-3. It is lined on its internal surface by columnar neuroepithelial cells. On the surface of the crista is a gelatinous structure that is composed of a protein polysaccharide material called the cupula, which extends across the lumen of the ampulla. This neuroepithelium is composed of two basic cell types, hair cells and supporting cells. The neurons of the vestibulocochlear nerve are derived from otic placod ectoderm. The dendritic zones of the neurons of the vestibular portion of the vestibulocochlear nerve are in synaptic contact with the base of the hair cells. These hair cells have on their luminal surface 40 to 80 hairs, or modified microvilli, stereocilia, and a single modified cilium, canicillium. These structures project into the overlying cupula. Movement of fluid in the semicircular duct causes deflection of the cupula, which is oriented transversely in the direction of flow of the endolymph. This deflection bends the stereocilia, which is the source of the stimulus by way of the hair cells, to the dendritic zone of the vestibular neuron that is in synaptic relationship with the plasmalema of the hair cell. At one end of each semicircular duct is one membranous ampulla with its crista ampullaris. Because the three semicircular ducts are all at right angles to each other, movement of the head in any plane or angular rotation affects a crista ampullaris and stimulates vestibular neurons. These cristae function in dynamic equilibrium. The vestibular neurons are tonically active, and their activity is excited or inhibited by deflection of the cupula in different directions. Each semicircular duct on one side is paired with a semicircular duct on the opposite side by their common position in a parallel plane. These synergistic pairs are the left and right lateral ducts, the left anterior and right posterior ducts, and the left posterior and right anterior ducts. When movement in the direction of one of these three planes stimulates the vestibular neurons of the crista of one duct, they are inhibited in the opposite duct of the synergistic pair. For example, rotation of the head to the right causes the endolymph to flow in the right lateral duct such that the cupula is deflected toward the utriculus and the cupula of the left lateral duct is deflected away from the utriculus. This action causes increased activity of vestibular neurons on the right side and decreased activity on the left side, resulting in a jerk nystagmus to the right side, which is an involuntary rhythmic oscillation of the eyes. The anatomic orientation of the stereocilia area relative to the kinocilium on the surface of the crista is responsible for the difference in activity relative to the direction of the cupula deflection. Deviation of the stereocilia toward the kinocilium increases vestibular neuron activity. These receptors are not affected by a constant velocity of movement but respond to acceleration or deceleration, especially when the head is rotated. Macula. The macula is the receptor found in each utriculus and saccule, which are located in the bony vestibule. The macula is on one surface of each of the sac-like structures. See figures 12-1 through 12-3. Each macula is an oval-shaped plaque in which the membranous labyrinth has proliferated. The surface of the macula consists of columnar epithelial cells. This neuroepithelium is composed of hair cells and supporting cells. Covering the neuroepithelium is a gelatinous material, the staticoneum, otolithic, membrane. On the surface of this membrane are calcareous crystalline bodies known as staticonia, otoliths. Similar to the hair cells of the cristae, the macular hair cells have projections of their luminal cell membranes, stereocilia and kinocilia, into the overlying staticonia or membrane. Movement of the staticonia away from these cells is the initiating factor in bending the stereocilia to stimulate an impulse in the dendritic zones of the vestibular neurons that are in synaptic relationship with the base of the hair cells. The macula in the saccule is oriented in a vertical direction, sagittal plane, whereas the macula of the utriculus is in a horizontal direction, dorsal plane. Thus, gravitational forces continually affect the position of the staticonia relative to the hair cells. These structures are responsible for the sensation of the static position of the head and linear acceleration or deceleration. They function in static equilibrium. The macula of the utriculus may be more important as a receptor for sensing changes in head posture, whereas the macula of the saccule may be more sensitive to vibrational stimuli and loud sounds. Vestibulooccipital nerve. Cranial nerve 8. Vestibular division. The dendritic zones of the vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8 are in a synaptic relationship with the hair cells of each crista ampullaris and the macula utriculi and macula sacculi. The axons course through the internal acoustic meatus with those of the cochlear division of this nerve. The cell bodies of these bipolar type sensory neurons are inserted along the course of the axons within the petrous portion of the temporal bone, where they form the vestibular ganglion. See figure 12-3. After leaving the internal acoustic meatus with the cochlear division of the vestibulooccipital nerve, the vestibular nerve axons pass to the lateral surface of the rostral medulla at the cerebellomedullary angle, which occurs at the level of the trapezoid body and the attachment of the caudal cerebellar peduncle to the cerebellum. The vestibular nerve axons enter the medulla between the caudal cerebellar peduncle and the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve and terminate in telodendria at one of two sites. The majority of them terminate in the vestibular nuclei in the medulla and pons. A few course directly into the cerebellum by way of the caudal peduncle and terminate in the vestigial nucleus in the cerebellar medulla and the cortex of the flocculonodular lobe. These latter axons form the direct vestibulocerebellar tract. Vestibular nuclei on either side of the dorsal part of the pons and medulla adjacent to the lateral wall of the fourth ventricle are four vestibular nuclei. Figure 12-4. See also figure 12-2. From the level of the rostral and middle cerebellar peduncles, they extend quadrilia to the level of the lateral cuneate nucleus and the lateral wall of the caudal portion of the fourth ventricle. The four nuclei are the rostral, medial, lateral, and caudal vestibular nuclei. They form a continuous column on each side of the pons and medulla. The rostral vestibular nucleus is located medial to the rostral and middle cerebellar peduncles, dorsal to the motor nucleus of the trigeminal nerve in the pons. The medial and lateral vestibular nuclei are located ventromedial to the confluence of the three cerebellar peduncles with the cerebellum. See figure 12-2 in plates 11 and 12 in chapter 2. They are dorsal to the ventrolateral projection of the axons of facial neurons. The medial nucleus continues caudally adjacent to the caudal vestibular nucleus in the dorsal medulla to the level of the lateral cuneate nucleus. See plate 13 in chapter 2. The lateral vestibular nucleus is only located at the level of the confluent cerebellar peduncles. The caudal vestibular nucleus is caudal to the lateral vestibular nucleus and continues caudally at the level of the lateral cuneate nucleus. The caudal cerebellar peduncle is dorsolateral to the caudal vestibular nucleus. The spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve and its nucleus are ventrolateral to the caudal vestibular nucleus in the medulla. These vestibular nuclei receive afferents from the vestibular division of the vestibulocochlear nerve. From the vestibular nuclei are numerous projections, which may be grouped into spinal cord, brainstem, and cerebellar pathways. See figure 12-4. Spinal cord. The lateral vestibulospinal tract courses caudally in the ipsilateral ventral funiculus through the entire spinal cord. Its axons terminate in all of the spinal cord segments on interneurons in the ventral gray columns. These interneurons are facilitatory to ipsilateral alpha and gamma motor neurons to extensor muscles, inhibitory to the ipsilateral alpha motor neurons to flexor muscles, and some interneurons cross to the opposite ventral gray column, where they are inhibitory to the contralateral alpha and gamma motor neurons to extensor muscles. See figure 12-2. Thus, the effect of stimulation of the neuronal cell bodies, the axons of which are in the vestibulospinal tract, is an ipsilateral extensor tonus and contralateral inhibition of this mechanism. The cell bodies of most of the axons in the lateral vestibulospinal tract are located in the lateral vestibular nucleus. The medial vestibulospinal tract arises from cell bodies in the rostral, medial, and caudal vestibular nuclei and passes caudally in the ipsilateral ventral funiculus of the cervical and cranial thoracic spinal cord segments. These axons terminate on interneurons in the ventral gray columns, which influence the activation of the alpha and gamma motor neurons that innervate primarily neck muscles. In addition, the medial vestibular nucleus projects axons into the medial longitudinal fasciculus, which courses caudally in the dorsal portion of the ventral funiculus through the cervical and cranial thoracic spinal cord segments. Through these spinal cord pathways, the position and activity of the limbs, neck, and trunk can be coordinated with movements of the head. Brainstem. Neuronal cell bodies in the vestibular nuclei have three general terminations in the brainstem. 1. Axons course rostrally in the medial longitudinal fasciculus, MLF, to terminate in the motor nuclei of cranial nerves. 4. 6. and 3. Their purpose is to provide coordinated conjugate eye movements associated with changes in the position of the head. In most normal animals, this eye movement may be readily elicited by repeatedly moving the animal's head from one side to the other and observing the jerk nystagmus that is produced. When the brainstem is severely contused by a head injury, these pathways may be disrupted, and eyeball movements cannot be elicited by changing the position of the head. This clinical sign usually indicates a poor prognosis because of the severity of the associated lesion needed to abolish this reflex. 2. Axons projects into the reticular formation. Some of these axons provide afferents to the vomiting center located there. This pathway is involved with motion sickness. 3. We are all readily aware of any loss of our balance. Balance requires a pathway for conscious perception that involves a relay through a thalamic nucleus. This pathway is not well defined for the vestibular system. It may be closely associated with the conscious pathway for the auditory system. Axons of neuronal cell bodies and vestibular nuclei course rostrally through the midbrain to terminate in the contralateral medial geniculate nucleus of the thalamus or some other thalamic nucleus. Synapse occurs here, and the axons of the cell bodies in the thalamic nucleus projects by way of the internal capsule to the cerebral cortex, probably the cortex in the temporal lobe. Interference with this conscious pathway would explain the occasional observation of clinical signs of a vestibular system dysfunction after the occurrence of an acute prosencephalic lesion. Cerebellum axons of neuronal cell bodies in the vestibular nuclei, in addition to some in the vestibular ganglia, projects to the cerebellum through the caudal cerebellar peduncle and terminate mostly in the cortex of the flocculus of the hemisphere and the nodulus of the vermis, the flocculonodular lobe. These axons have collaterals that synapse in the vestigial nucleus, which is the most medial of the three nuclei in the cerebellar medulla. See plates 12 and 13 in Chapter 2. Through these pathways, the vestibular system functions to coordinate the position of the eyes, neck, trunk, and limbs with the position and movements of the head. The system maintains equilibrium during active and passive movement and when the head is at rest. Interference with the system results in varying degrees of loss of balance and abnormal head position. Clinical signs of vestibular system disease. Vestibular system disease produces varying degrees of loss of equilibrium, causing imbalance and a unique quality of ataxia that is designated vestibular ataxia as opposed to general proprioceptive ataxia and cerebellar ataxia. Clinical neurologists think about and describe disorders of the vestibular system as peripheral or central. Only minor differences exist in the clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction between lesions of this system in the petrous portion of the temporal bone, peripheral, or the vestibular nuclei on one side of the medulla or the vestibular components of the cerebellum, central. Determining whether the vestibular system signs reflect a dysfunction of the peripheral or central components of the vestibular system depends more on recognition of clinical signs caused by the dysfunction of other systems located in the brain, stem, or cerebellum. As a rule, the most common diseases that affect the peripheral components of the vestibular system are less serious than those that affect the central components. We will first describe the clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction as they would occur with a complete disruption of the vestibular receptors or vestibular nerve in the petrous portion of the temporal bone. These signs are the clinical signs of peripheral vestibular disease. Unilateral peripheral vestibular disease. Unilateral disease of the peripheral components of the vestibular system is characterized by an asymmetric ataxia with loss of balance but with preservation of strength. No loss of general proprioception occurs in peripheral vestibular system disease. Therefore, these patients know exactly where their limbs are in space, and no paresis is present. Thus, they can support weight well, normal lower motor neuron, LMN, activity, and move their limbs rapidly, normal upper motor neuron, UMN, and general proprioception, GP, activity, to avoid falling as a result of balance loss. The clinical signs will be recognized on your observation of the posture and gait of the patient and on your examination of the posture and movement of the eyes. Abnormal posture and vestibular ataxia. Normally, a constant flow of neuronal impulses occurs from the receptors in the inner ear to the vestibular system components in the pons, medulla, and cerebellum. When a disorder interrupts that neuronal activity, the central components of the vestibular system lose this source of active ion, which results in the characteristic clinical signs related to a peripheral vestibular system disorder. These clinical signs are discussed below. Loss of coordination between the head and the neck, trunk, and limbs is reflected in a head tilt, with a more ventral ear directed toward the side of the vestibular system disorder. The degree of head tilt may vary from just a few degrees that may be difficult to recognize to nearly 45 degrees with a patient having difficulty standing up. To recognize the mild head tilt, you need to observe the patient's head from directly in front of the patient and with your head at the level of the head of the patient. The neck and trunk will lean, fall, or even roll toward the side of the lesion. The neck and trunk may be flexed laterally with the concavity directed toward the side of the lesion. The patient may tend to circle toward the affected side. These circles are usually small diameter circles, which will appear as though the patient is falling in that direction. Animals that propulsively circle from prosencephalic lesions have no ataxia or other signs of vestibular system dysfunction and usually walk in wider circles. Be aware that cats with vestibular system disease will often adopt a crouched stance. This should not be misinterpreted as paresis. When picked up, cats will often try to reach out and grab and claw at the ground or the individual that picked them up, so be aware of this and do not get injured. Occasionally, it may be possible to elicit mild hypertonia in the limbs on the side of the body opposite to the side of the vestibular system lesion. This is best appreciated when you alter the patient's position by picking it up or moving it from one recumbency to another. The asymmetry of the ataxia may be explained by the loss of tonic activity in the vestibulospinal tract on the side of the lesion, which removes facilitation of ipsilateral extensor muscles and a source of inhibition of contralateral extensor muscles. The unopposed activity of the contralateral vestibulospinal tract causes the neck and trunk to be forced toward the side of the lesion by excessive unopposed extensor muscle tonus. The entire body will lean, fall, or roll toward the side of the lesion. With peripheral vestibular system disorders, rolling is usually limited to the first 24 to 48 hours after upper acute onset of clinical signs. If the rolling persists longer than that, the lesion more likely involves the central components of the vestibular system. Frequently, the patient falls when it shakes its head, with only the vestibular system affected. These patients will make very rapid and short limb movements in their attempt to maintain balance. When you evaluate a patient with vestibular system dysfunction, you should ask yourself if this patient knows where its limbs are in space. The answer will certainly be yes if only the peripheral vestibular system is affected. Patients with vestibular ataxia use their eyes to help maintain balance. Therefore, blindfolding these patients usually makes their vestibular ataxia ataxia worse. This tactic is most helpful when you are not sure if the vestibular system is involved in the patient's clinical signs. Be cautious when you perform this test with large animals so that they do not fall and injure themselves or the observers. For horses and cattle, use a folded towel that is slipped under the halter so that it can be readily removed by pulling on one edge of the towel. Never tie the blindfold onto the halter. Cats often carry their tails elevated straight dorsally when they have a significant balance loss. In dogs, the tail will also be carried abnormally, often making jerky movements toward the affected side. Normal nystagmus. Nystagmus is an involuntary rhythmic oscillation of the eyes. Oscillating eye movements that are equal in each direction indicate a pendular nystagmus, which is uncommon, usually benign, and associated with congenital visual system pathway abnormalities. Eye movements that are unequal, with a slow movement, slow phase, in one direction and a fast return, quick phase, of the eye to its starting position, indicate a jerk nystagmus, which may be normal or abnormal and reflect a dysfunction in the vestibular system. The direction of the nystagmus, by convention, is ascribed to the direction of the quick or fast phase of the jerk nystagmus. Both eyes are usually affected and usually in the same direction. This jerk nystagmus is a normal response to any rapid movement of the head. Stand over any normal dog, and watch its eyes as you move the head in a horizontal dorsal plane from side to side. You will observe a horizontal jerk nystagmus. As you move the Oni Mouse head to the right, both eyes will repeatedly jerk quickly to the right with a slow return to the left. As you move its head to the left, the opposite will happen. Both eyes will repeatedly jerk quickly to the left and slowly return to the right. This procedure is termed normal vestibular or physiologic nystagmus. Some textbooks refer to this response as vestibular ocular nystagmus, or doll's eye response. It evaluates not only the vestibular system, which is the sensory arm of this response, but also the medial longitudinal fasciculus in the brainstem and the abducens nervi nervi, scion of the lateral rectus muscle that abducts the eye, and the oculomotor nerve innervation of the medial rectus muscle that adducts the eye. If you flex and extend the animal's neck so that the head moves up and down, the same eye movements will occur in a vertical direction. This event is a vertical jerk nystagmus. The quick phase of the nystagmus is always in the direction of the head movement. This response is a normal reflex in which the slow component is initiated by way of the vestibular receptors in the membranous labyrinth, and the quick component involves a brainstem center related to the vestibular system. This reflex is important in maintaining visual fixation on stationary points as the body rotates. Abnormal nystagmus when the head is held in its normal extended neutral position, or if held flexed laterally to either side or held fully extended at rest. No nystagmus will occur in the normal animal. It normally occurs only when you move the Oni Mouse head. With dysfunction of the vestibular system, a jerk nystagmus may be observed. If it is observed when the head is held in its normal extended neutral position, it is called resting or spontaneous nystagmus. If it is induced only by holding the head fixed in lateral flexion or full extension, it is called positional nystagmus. These events are both forms of abnormal nystagmus. If you are suspicious of the possibility of a vestibular system disorder, it may be useful to look for positional nystagmus when you place the patient on its back with its neck extended. Remember that it is normal for nystagmus to occur only while you are moving the animal's head, not when the head is stationary. How do you explain this abnormal nystagmus? If you consider the existence of a continual bilateral stimulation of peripheral vestibular neurons that constantly project to the middle of the position or movement of the head, and that this provides a balanced tonic stimulation of the vestibular nuclei on each side and from there to the nuclei that innervate the extraocular muscles, then any interruption of this balanced tonic stimulation might result in an alteration at the nuclei of the neurons that innervate extraocular muscles that results in nystagmus. With peripheral vestibular diseases, the imbalance represents a loss of tonic stimulation of the vestibular nuclei from the affected side. In disorders of the peripheral vestibular system, the abnormal resting or positional nystagmus is directed in a horizontal dorsal plane or is rotatory but is always directed, quick phase, away from the side of the lesion or head tilt. To determine the direction of a rotatory nystagmus, observe the direction that the 12 o'clock position of the pupil moves during the quick phase. The direction of the fast phase does not change when the position of the head is changed. Occasionally, an abnormal positional nystagmus may appear vertical, especially when the patient is in dorsal recumbency. Previous theories suggested that vertical nystagmus only occurred with disorders of the central vestibular system, but we now believe this idea may be incorrect and oversimplified. Some patients with disorders of the peripheral vestibular system have almost a vertical nystagmus, but careful examination will usually reveal a slight rotatory component. We no longer use vertical nystagmus alone to distinguish peripheral from central vestibular system disease. With disorders of the central components of the vestibular system, the nystagmus may be horizontal, rotatory, or vertical. It may be directed toward or away from the side of the lesion, and it may change in direction with the head held in different positions. Thus, the presence of nystagmus that is directed toward the side of the lesion or head tilt or changes direction with changes in the position of the head are the only reliable features of the abnormal nystagmus that indicate a central involvement of the vestibular system. Many patients with central vestibular system disease will have abnormal nystagmus that is horizontal or rotatory and is directed to the side opposite to the side of the lesion and does not change its direction with changes in head position. Therefore, to determine a disorder of the central vestibular system, you must identify clinical signs of the central lesion that involve other neurologic systems, especially the UMN and GP systems. Resting nystagmus is more common in acute disorders of the peripheral components of the vestibular system, and the rate of either resting or positional nystagmus tends to be more rapid than when the disorder is in the central components of the vestibular system. Some patients with severe resting nystagmus exhibit a slight head rotation that occurs simultaneously with the nystagmus corresponding to its rate and direction. In addition, a simultaneous eyelid blink may be seen concomitant with the nystagmus, which presumably is a reflex action. These latter two findings are very common in rabbits. Normal nystagmus requires normal function of the vestibular system components, normal medial longitudinal fasciculus bilaterally, and normal general somatic efferent, GSE, neurons in the motor nuclei of the abducens, trochlear, and oculomotor nerves. Abnormal nystagmus indicates a disruption in the normal bilateral balance of sensory information from the peripheral vestibular receptor and the activity of the central components of the vestibular system. No normal or abnormal nystagmus may occur with bilateral loss of function in the peripheral vestibular system, its central components, the medial longitudinal fasciculus, or the GSC motor nuclei of the abducens, trochlear, and oculomotor nerves. Bilateral loss of peripheral vestibular function is the most common cause of the complete absence of any normal or abnormal nystagmus. Both bilateral otitis interna and bilateral idiopathic dysfunction have been diagnosed. Postoperatory nystagmus: if an animal is rotated rapidly, with acceleration, the labyrinth moves around the endolymph, which deflects the cupula of the crista ampullaris, stimulating the vestibular nerve and thus eliciting eye movements. The quick face is in the direction of the rotation, but this aspect cannot be seen as the animal is moving. In time, the rotation of the endolymph reaches the same speed of rotation of the labyrinth. At this constant velocity, the cupulae are not deflected. Thus, no rotatory stimulus reaches the vestibular nerve, and nystagmus does not occur. When the rotation is suddenly stopped, once again, a disparity occurs in the rotation of the labyrinth and the endolymph. The labyrinth is stationary, and the endolymph continues to flow for a short interval during which it deflects the cupulae. Vestibular neurons are stimulated, and nystagmus occurs. However, the direction of flow is opposite to that which occurred during acceleration, and the quick phase of the nystagmus is directed opposite to the direction of the rotation. The speed and duration of this postoperatory nystagmus are variable but should be approximately equal when the response to rotation is compared for both directions. Vestibular system disease is suspected when a different response is elicited to spinning in one direction compared with the other. As a rule, when the patient is rotated in a direction opposite to the side of a peripheral receptor lesion, postoperatory nystagmus is depressed. This postoperatory test stimulates both labyrinths. However, the labyrinth on the outside of the rotation, on the side of the head opposite to the direction of rotation, is stimulated more because it is farther away from the axis of rotation, which may explain the abnormal postoperatory nystagmus that is observed with unilateral peripheral vestibular disease. On rotating the patient away from the side of the lesion, the diseased labyrinth is farthest from the axis of rotation. It cannot be stimulated properly because of the lesion, and a depressed postoperatory response may be observed. This test can be performed only on patients that are small enough to be picked up and held with your elbows extended. It requires two people, the holder and the examiner. The holder directs the head of the patient away from his or her body and spins in a circle as rapidly as possible for 6 to 7 rotations and stops suddenly. The examiner immediately grasps the head of the patient and observes the eyes for nystagmus. The eyes of the holder will show the same postoperatory response. Some large dogs may be secured in a rotating desk chair and the chair spun. In most small animals, this postoperatory response can be readily elicited. We perform this test only when the clinical signs of a peripheral vestibular disorder settle and a need exists for more supportive information, or in a patient that is suspected of having a bilateral peripheral vestibular system disorder in which no normal nystagmus will occur. It is not reliable for determining the side of the lesion. Additionally, no difference exists in the number of beats of postoperatory nystagmus in patients with peripheral vestibular signs compared with central vestibular signs. Caloric nystagmus: the vestibular receptors of each inner ear may be tested separately by using the caloric test. Irrigation of the external ear canal with ice cold water or warm water for 3 to 5 minutes causes the endolymph to flow in the semicircular ducts. Using cold water, this test normally induces a jerk nystagmus to the side opposite to the ear being stimulated. If the peripheral receptor on the side being stimulated is non-functional because of a disease process, no nystagmus will be observed with this caloric test. Covering the patient's eyes may prevent voluntary repression of the response by fixation on an object in the environment of the visual field. This test is useful in humans who can be restrained in an adjustable chair that will permit not only the testing of an individual ear but also individual semicircular ducts. Most animals need considerable physical restraint for this test to be performed, and as seen in our experience, some normal dogs do not exhibit any nystagmus with prolonged irrigation of the ear canal with cold water. Thus, this caloric testing is both unreliable and not practical in our animal patients, so we avoid using it. Strabismus: strabismus is an abnormal position of the eye relative to the orbit or palpebral fissure that is a clinical sign of loss of innervation to the extraocular muscles and was described with the cranial nerves in Chapter 6. Strabismus is visible in all positions of the head. In the normal small animal, when the head and neck are extended in the tonic-neck reaction, the eye should elevate and remain in the center of the palpebral fissures. With disorders of any component of the vestibular system, this effect may not occur on the side of the lesion, resulting in a dropped or ventrally deviated eye that exposes the sclera dorsally. Occasionally, a slight ventral or ventrolateral strabismus is observed without head and neck extension but disappears when the head position is changed. This action will mimic an oculomotor nerve strabismus. However, when you move the animal's head side to side to test for normal physiologic nystagmus, the affected eye will adduct and abduct well, indicating that cranial nerves 3 and 6 are not impaired. This inconstant abnormal eye position is known as vestibular strabismus. You should look for this impairment when you hold the animal's head and neck in extension because it may be the only clinical sign observed in mild disorders of the vestibular system. This vestibular strabismus will be on the same side as the lesion in the vestibular system. In farm animals, it is normal for their eyes to not elevate completely when the head and neck are extended. Therefore, you expect to see some sclera dorsal to the cornea in these species, but it should be equal on both sides. Horses may exhibit a slight ventral deviation of the eyes when their heads and necks are extended, but their size makes this observation difficult. Postural reactions: the vestibular system is the only system involved with movement of the animal that, when deficient, does not interfere with the performance of the postural reactions. Hopping, hammer walking, placing, and paw or hoof replacement will all be normal. Only the animal's ability to right itself from a recumbent position may be altered, and this action toward the side of the lesion may be exaggerated. In the worst situation, the patient may continually roll in that direction. The ability to perform these postural reactions, except for righting, is critical to determining whether the vestibular system disorder involves the peripheral or central components of the vestibular system. You need to repeat the hopping responses many times to be sure that they are normal in your patient with peripheral vestibular disease. In patients with severe loss of their ability to balance, holding them securely to perform these postural reactions may be difficult. With an acute onset of severe loss of balance, delaying or repeating this part of the neurologic examination after 24 hours may be necessary to allow time for the most severe clinical signs to abate enough so that you can handle the patient for this examination. The ground surface must not be slippery and should provide good traction for the patient. Be careful when you pick up these patients because severe disorientation will be initiated, and they will thrash their limbs to seek a supporting surface. If you suddenly pick up a cat with this disorder, you are in danger of being grasped by the struggling patient. Vomiting as a continuous event is an uncommon clinical sign of vestibular system dysfunction in domestic animals. However, in approximately 25% of animals presented with an acute onset of vestibular system dysfunction, the owners will report observing an episode of vomiting at the onset of clinical signs. Bilateral peripheral vestibular system disease: when the peripheral components of the vestibular system are dysfunctional bilaterally, as in a patient with bilateral otitis media interna or an idiopathic disorder, no postural asymmetry is noted. Balance is lost to both sides, resulting in the patient assuming a crouched posture closer to the ground surface. They may often walk well but are often slow and cautious to avoid falling, especially when they move their head suddenly. The most characteristic clinical sign is the presence of wide head excursions. When the patient moves its head to either side to look at objects in its environment, the movement is greater than normal, which gives the appearance that the lateral head excursions cannot be stopped and the movement is prolonged. These wide head excursions occur to both sides, occur almost continuously as the patient walks into the same degree, and may occasionally be accompanied by a brief staggering movement. Because no functional vestibular receptors or vestibular nerves exist, no stimulus is projected into the brainstem and to the cranial nerves that move the eyes. Therefore, no normal or abnormal nystagmus can be observed. If the head and neck are extended in these patients and then the support is suddenly withdrawn, the head may rapidly descend ventrally beyond the normal neutral position. This action is termed a head rebound phenomenon and is a clinical sign of cerebellar dysfunction but also may occur with bilateral peripheral vestibular dysfunction. Central vestibular system disease: we have already indicated that the only clinical signs of dysfunction of the vestibular system that occur with DES of the central components of the vestibular system and not with peripheral vestibular system disorders are the presence of an abnormal nystagmus that changes directions when the position of the head is changed, or a horizontal or rotatory nystagmus directed toward the side of the head tilt and body deviation. If the nystagmus is absolutely vertical, the disorder is most likely in the central components of the vestibular system. Be aware that what appears to be vertical may have a slight rotary component, which may occur with peripheral vestibular system disorders. The most reliable clinical sign that determines that a lesion exists in the pons or medulla affecting the vestibular nuclei is an ipsilateral postural reaction deficit or a recognizable spastic hemiparesis and ataxia from involvement of the UMN and GP systems adjacent to these nuclei in the caudal brainstem. Clinical signs of cerebellar dysfunction and or cranial nerve dysfunction other than the facial or vestibulocochlear nerves implicate a central or pontomedullary location for the clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction. Remember that facial paralysis and Horner syndrome may occur along with clinical signs of vestibular nerve dysfunction with diseases of the middle and inner ear in small animals and just facial paralysis in the horse and farm animals. Lesions that involve solely the vestibular nuclei on one side cause ipsilateral clinical signs similar to all the lesions that affect the peripheral components of the vestibular system with a patient's head tilt and loss of balance directed toward the side of the lesion. Paradoxical vestibular system disease: paradoxical vestibular system disease is a unique syndrome in which the head tilt and loss of balance are directed toward the side opposite to the central lesion, which usually involves the caudal cerebellar peduncle. An explanation for this paradox in the direction of the clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction is based on the rule that the direction of the head tilt and balance loss will be toward the side of the least vestibular system activity. When we describe the physiologic anatomy of the cerebellum in Chapter 13, you will learn that the Purkinje neurons that form a single layer of cells in the cerebellar cortex are the only neurons that project their axons from the cerebellar cortex. These neurons are all inhibitory neurons that release gamma-aminobutyric acid at their telodendria. Most of these neurons terminate via their telodendria on neuronal cell bodies in the cerebellar nuclei, which are located in the central portion of the cerebellum known as the cerebellar medulla. The neurons in these cerebellar nuclei comprise the majority of the efferent axons that leave the cerebellum to terminate in various brainstem nuclei. An exception to this rule is a small population of Purkinje neurons, most of which are located in the cortex of the folia of the flocculus and the hemisphere and the nodulus in the vermis. The Purkinje neurons of these cortical areas of axons that leave the cerebellum directly as a component of the caudal cerebellar peduncle. They terminate in the vestibular nuclei, where they are inhibitory to the activation of these neuronal cell bodies. A lesion in the caudal cerebellar peduncle interferes with this inhibition, resulting in excessive discharge of vestibular system neurons on that side. The imbalance in vestibular system activation between the two sides is recognized as a head tilt and loss of balance to the side opposite to this lesion because, as a rule, the direction of the head tilt and balance loss will be toward the side with the least activity of the vestibular system. This paradoxical syndrome is in contrast to lesions that cause a loss of activation of the neuronal cell bodies in the vestibular nuclei as seen in disorders of the peripheral components of the vestibular system or within the vestibular nuclei themselves. Experimental studies support our clinical observations and proposed explanation. Ablation of the caudal cerebellar peduncle dorsal to the medulla on one side will produce a head tilt and balance loss directed toward the side opposite to the lesion with the nystagmus directed toward the side of the lesion. If the vestibular nuclei are included in this lesion, the head tilt and balance loss will be directed toward the side of the lesion, and the nystagmus will be toward the side opposite to the lesion, similar to disorders of the vestibular nerve or its receptors. Similarly, ablation of the flocculus and nodulus within the cerebellum will produce this paradoxical vestibular system syndrome, with the clinical signs directed toward the side opposite to the cerebellar lesion. However, experimental ablation of the vestigial nucleus, a source of activation of the vestibular nuclei, causes ipsilateral vestibular system signs. In clinical practice, the side of this unilateral lesion will be determined determined on your neurologic examination by the side of the postural reaction deficit or the side of the hemiparesis and ataxia, which will be ipsilateral to the lesion. The caudal cerebellar peduncle lesion will be contralateral to the direct chion of the head tilt in paradoxical vestibular system disease. The caudal cerebellar peduncle lesion that causes the paradoxical vestibular system clinical signs also interferes with GP afferents that are entering the cerebellum. Their interruption will cause ipsilateral ataxia and a deficit in postural reactions. The lesions that affect the caudal cerebellar peduncle and cause the paradoxical vestibular system signs are variable and most commonly include infarcts, neoplasms, and inflammations. In our experience, most of these lesions, when unilateral, also affect the UMN system to the ipsilateral neck, trunk, and limbs and ipsilateral GSELMNs and cranial nerves. In our clinical experience, paradoxical central vestibular signs are rarely observed in cats. In contrast, it is relatively frequently encountered in dogs. This difference cannot be explained based simply on more dogs being evaluated than cats. At our practices are a greater frequency of diseases with a predilection for the cerebellum in dogs than in cats. We believe that a likely anatomic explanation exists to account for this observation, but its description has yet to be made. Be aware that clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction will occur if the spinal nerve, dorsal roots, or dorsal gray matter of the first three cervical spinal cord segments are interrupted. This dysfunction has been observed in experimental animals in which these roots have been transected or blocked with a local anesthetic agent. Presumably, this is caused by the loss of GP afferents from neuromuscular spindles, which are critical for maintaining normal orientation of the head with the neck. Spinal cord lesions at this level that interrupt the spinovestibular tracts may have the same effect. We have observed temporary clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction in three dogs after resection of extraparenchymal spinal cord tumors at the level of the C1 and C2 vertebrae, presumably from surgical trauma to these spinal cord segments or possibly the dorsal roots. These clinical signs resolved in all three dogs within a 3 to 5 day period. It is of interest that some people and possibly animals may either have a smaller number of rootlets or complete lack of the dorsal root associated with the first cervical spinal cord segment. Whether this has any clinical implications is unknown. Vestibular system diseases dogs in clinical practice. The side of this unilateral lesion will be determined on your neurologic examination by the side of the postural reaction deficit or the side of the hemiparesis and ataxia, which will be ipsilateral to the lesion. The caudal cerebellar peduncle lesion will be contralateral to the direct chion of the head tilt in paradoxical vestibular system disease. The caudal cerebellar peduncle lesion that causes the paradoxical vestibular system clinical signs also interferes with GP afferents that are entering the cerebellum. Their interruption will cause ipsilateral ataxia and a deficit in postural reactions. The lesions that affect the caudal cerebellar peduncle and cause the paradoxical vestibular system signs are variable and most commonly include infarcts, neoplasms, and inflammations. In our experience, most of these lesions, when unilateral, also affect the UMN system to the ipsilateral neck, trunk, and limbs and ipsilateral GSELMNs and cranial nerves. In our clinical experience, paradoxical central vestibular signs are rarely observed in cats. In contrast, it is relatively frequently encountered in dogs. This difference cannot be explained based simply on more dogs being evaluated than cats. At our practices are a greater frequency of diseases with a predilection for the cerebellum in dogs than in cats. We believe that a likely anatomic explanation exists to account for this observation, but its description has yet to be made. Be aware that clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction will occur if the spinal nerve, dorsal roots, or dorsal gray matter of the first three cervical spinal cord segments are interrupted. This dysfunction has been observed in experimental animals in which these roots have been transected or blocked with a local anesthetic agent. Presumably, this is caused by the loss of GP afferents from neuromuscular spindles, which are critical for maintaining normal orientation of the head with the neck. Spinal cord lesions at this level that interrupt the spinovestibular tracts may have the same effect. We have observed temporary clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction in three dogs after resection of extraparenchymal spinal cord tumors at the level of the C1 and C2 vertebrae, presumably from surgical trauma to these spinal cord segments or possibly the dorsal roots. These clinical signs resolved in all three dogs within a 3 to 5 day period. It is of interest that some people and possibly animals may either have a smaller number of rootlets or complete lack of the dorsal root associated with the first cervical spinal cord segment. Whether this has any clinical implications is unknown. Chapter 12 Vestibular System, Special Proprioception 347 Case Example 12-1 Signalment, 14-year-old male golden retriever, Sunny chief complaint, inability to stand up history. The owners were reading at 7 p.m. when they heard a thrashing in their bedroom and found Sunny throwing himself around as he tried unsuccessfully to stand. They wrapped him in a blanket and brought him to the hospital, where he was examined and found unable to stand at that time. The video was made 6 hours after the sudden onset of these clinical signs, 5 hours after his hospitalization. Examination, see video 12-1. Note how rapidly this dog moves his limbs to maintain his balance and his normal rapid hopping responses. The importance of this observation is that UMN paresis and GP ataxia are absent, as these systems are unaffected, and Sunny's difficulty with walking is related to his severe loss of balance. Also note the abnormal spontaneous nystagmus, with the fast face to the right. Anatomic diagnosis, left peripheral vestibular system, membranous labyrinth, vestibular receptors, vestibular nerve portion of cranial nerve 8, vestibular ganglion, differential diagnosis, benign idiopathic canine peripheral vestibular disease, otitis media interna, ototoxicity benign idiopathic canine peripheral vestibular disease. Benign idiopathic canine peripheral vestibular disease is the most presumptive clinical diagnosis in this patient based on the per-acute onset, the age of the dog, and clinical signs limited to the peripheral components of the vestibular system predominantly on one side. Whether the cochlear nerve or its receptors are also involved is unknown, given that unilateral deafness cannot be reliably diagnosed without the use of electrodiagnostic equipment. Because this disorder is most prevalent in aged dogs, it is often termed geriatric canine peripheral vestibular disease. The cause of the disorder is unknown. Microscopic study of the inner ear of euthanized patients is uncommon because most dogs recover spontaneously. In addition, the procedure is not routine in most autopsy rooms, and the process of decalcification of the petrosal portion of the temporal bone that is required makes recognition of subtle abnormalities difficult. The rapid recovery suggests that this disease may be a functional disorder, possibly an alteration in the production and absorption of endolymph that causes increased pressure within the membranous labyrinth. This theory has been proposed for the pathogenesis of Meniere's disease in humans, which is an episodic disorder of the inner ear components. Vestibular neuritis is described in humans to have an acute onset of clinical signs of a peripheral vestibular system dysfunction. Spontaneous recovery occurs. A herpes virus-induced vestibular ganglionitis and an autoimmune inner ear inflammation have also been proposed in humans. Paroxysmal positional vertigo, dizziness, in humans has been related to one or more statoconia that detach from the statoconia membrane and lodge in one of the semicircular ducts. In humans with this disorder, recovery is associated with specific head position adjustments to dislodge the statoconia. Many of the acute peripheral vestibular diseases of humans are not well understood. The idiopathic canine disorder is rarely observed before 5 years of age. The clinical signs are usually pre-acute in onset and rapidly improve to near complete resolution by 1 to 3 weeks from the onset. Residual clinical signs are uncommon. A few dogs may have a persistent head tilt. However, recurrences occasionally occur after a variable period of weeks to months. The onset of clinical signs may occur at any time of the year, which differs from a similar clinical syndrome that is seen in cats. With this rapid spontaneous recovery and without knowing the cause of this disorder, no basis exists for specific treatment. In the first 24 to 48 hours when the clinical signs are severe and incapacitating, treatment with diazepam, Valium or, to a lesser extent, meclizine, Antivert, may decrease the intensity of the clinical signs. Diazepam or similar drugs are used in a variety of vestibular system disorders in humans. In the past, this disorder was incorrectly diagnosed as a stroke, that is, a brain infarction, which often resulted in the unnecessary euthanasia of the animal. This practice is inexcusable with the present level of veterinary knowledge. Severe clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction often accompany the development of cerebellar ischemic lesions or infarcts, stroke, but the neurologic examination should support the anatomic diagnosis of a cerebellar disorder. In addition, the clinical signs of this predominantly cerebellar disorder may also resolve spontaneously or at least improve remarkably. Similar to the benign idiopathic peripheral vestibular disease, if you are presented with a dog within a few hours of the per-acute onset of the clinical signs of a peripheral vestibular disorder, the patient's severe disorientation may make performing a complete neurologic examination impossible. Evaluation of the postural reactions is critical to making the correct anatomic diagnosis. If your anatomic diagnosis of the location of the vestibular system disorder is dependent on the results of your postural reaction testing, we recommend confining the patient to a cage and re-evaluating the patient over the next 12 to 24 hours before proceeding with ancillary procedures. The key to effectively evaluating severely affected animals is to perform postural reaction tests very slowly so as to prevent rapid changes in the patient's position. Rapid changes in position often precipitate clinical signs. In some patients, it may only be possible to perform poor placement early in the course of their disorder. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, to date, has been normal in the patients with this peripheral vestibular system disorder. As MRI technology improves and we gain more experience, abnormalities may possibly be found, especially if an inflammatory disorder is present. Otitis media interna is the greatest concern in the differential diagnosis when the clinical signs are limited to the peripheral components of the vestibular system. Facial paralysis and Horner syndrome often occur with otitis media interna in small animals but never occur with a benign idiopathic disorder. The per-acute onset of severe clinical signs of peripheral vestibular system dysfunction is less common in otitis media interna. Certainly, the first diagnostic step in evaluating all patients with peripheral vestibular system disease is to do a thorough otoscopic examination. Imaging procedures are the most reliable in supporting the diagnosis of otitis media interna. Ototoxicity should be supported by a history of exposure to drugs that affect inner ear function. Degeneration of the vestibular or cochlear labyrinthine receptors or both may occur with high levels of aminoglycoside antibiotics. These drugs include streptomycin, amikacin, kanamycin, neomycin, gentamicin, and vancomycin. Streptomycin most often affects the vestibular system receptors in cats. The other antibiotics more often affect the cochlear receptors, but both types of receptors are susceptible to degeneration from any of these antibiotics. Clinical signs are usually unilateral but occasionally bilateral clinical signs occur. Spontaneous recovery will occur only if the diagnosis is made promptly and the exposure period is short before drug removal. Hypothyroidism-induced ischemic neuropathy of the vestibulocochlear nerve is a rare cause of acute clinical signs of a peripheral vestibular system disorder. This diagnosis is supported by clinical laboratory findings of a primary hypothyroidism and severe hypercholesterolemia. The ischemic neuropathy may be a result of hypothyroidism-induced atherosclerosis or increased blood viscosity due to hypertriglyceridemia involving the labyrinthine artery. This pathogenesis has yet to be confirmed. It is not known if the rapid recovery that follows thyroid supplementation is a result of the treatment or spontaneous recovery. In the southeastern part of the United States, where the blue-tailed lizard is common, many veterinarians believe that acute peripheral vestibular system dysfunction occurs in cats shortly after they eat the tail of this lizard. Additional clinical signs include vomiting, trembling, salivation, and hyperirritability from more diffuse involvement of the nervous system. A few deaths have been reported. Further careful studies of this presumed toxicity are necessary. We have no experience with this unique disorder. See the following videos for other examples of benign idiopathic canine peripheral vestibular disease. Video 12-2 shows Iris, a 13-year-old spayed female Norwich Terrier, 24 hours after the sudden onset of severe disorientation, inability to stand, and frequent rolling to the right side. During the videotaping, I could not get the left pelvic limb to hop, but this feature was normal a few hours later. The last portion of the video was made 2 months after the first and shows Iris completely recovered without any treatment. Video 12-3 shows Sunny, a 12-year-old spayed female mixed breed with a sudden onset of what the owner described as seizure-like activity based on eye shaking and eyelid twitching. However, Sunny was still well aware of her environment and was able to recognize the owner. The video was made 18 hours after the onset of clinical signs. Repeating the hopping responses many times was necessary on Sunny before I was comfortable the responses were normal in this dog with a severe disorientation. Video 12-4 shows Jude, a 13-year-old female board her collie, 4 days after a sudden onset of a left head tilt and loss of balance. Initially, she could not stand without assistance. Polycranial neuritis and idiopathic inflammation has been recognized and described in the trigeminal nerve of dogs and has been suspected in acute facial paralysis of dogs and acute peripheral vestibular disorders of both dogs and cats. These acute cranial nerve disorders most commonly occur as a single cranial nerve event in the affected patient. Unilateral signs usually predominate in both the facial paralysis and vestibular system disorders. The trigeminal neuritis is not recognized until it is bilateral and the patient cannot close its mouth. However, various combinations of deficits of cranial nerves V7 and 8, vestibular, have also been recognized in a single patient. In some patients, the clinical signs suggest that the presumptive inflammation is limited to specific branches of a cranial nerve or a specific level of the nerve, proximal versus distal. Numerous communications exist between the branches of the trigeminal and facial nerves, which may facilitate spread of an infection or inflammation. See Chapter 7 for the involvement of the autonomic elements present in cranial nerves 5 and 7. The spread of disease, including neoplasms, through cranial nerves and their interconnections has been referred to as perineural spread in humans. Polycranial neuritis affects dogs more than cats. MRI, to date, has been normal, which makes otitis an unlikely cause of deficits of cranial nerves 7 and 8. Similarly, CSF is usually normal, although a slight elevation may occur in protein and leukocytes, with a mild lymphocytic pleocytosis. Be aware that with lesions that affect the motor component of the trigeminal nerve, the denervation of the tensor veli palatini muscle may result in fluid accumulation in the tympanic bulla. This is not otitis media, which it resembles on imaging. The pathogenesis of this polycranial neuritis remains to be determined. We suggest that these may all be examples of neuritis of various portions of the trigeminal, facial, and vestibular nerves. Polycranial neuritis may be a form of immune-mediated disease. However, an infectious agent or its antigen that may be responsible for a molecular mimicry that results in this disease has not been identified. The duration of the clinical disorder in a patient is dependent on the ratio of primary demyelination and primary axonal degeneration. When the latter predominates, the recovery will be delayed or may not occur. Case example 12-2 Signalment, 4-year-old castrated male golden retriever, Bozo chief complaint, head tilt and tearing history. 8 days before the examination, the owner noticed evidence of excessive tearing on the right side of Bozo's face. 4 days later, the dog had developed a right head tilt. Examination, see video 12-5. Note the lack of a right palpebral reflex but the retraction of the eye with the elevation of the third eyelid and the lack of lip and ear tone on the right but a straight philtrum. And note that the clinical signs of peripheral vestibular system dysfunction are limited to the head tilt and abnormal nystagmus. This dog's balance is normal. Anatomic diagnosis, right cranial nerve 7 and 8, vestibular nerve or its labyrinthine receptors. Differential diagnosis, right otitis media interna, neoplasm involving the right temporal bone, polycranial neuritis otitis media interna. Otitis media interna is the most common cause of this combination of cranial nerve 7 and 8 dysfunction. However, the neurologic examination must show no postural reaction deficits, which, if present, would indicate a medullary lesion, possibly affecting these two cranial nerves as well. In small animals, the ganglionic sympathetic axons that innervate smooth muscle in the orbit course through are adjacent to the tympanic cavity, where they can be affected by the inflammation in middle ear infections. It is not known whether the dysfunction of the peripheral vestibular system requires inflammation within the inner ear or whether the alteration in pressure and temperature caused by the inflammation within the tympanic cavity is sufficient to cause these clinical signs. Alternatively, toxins elaborated by bacteria may diffuse from the middle ear into the inner ear. Otitis media is very common in small animals, especially cats and young farm animals, which includes calves, lambs, kids, cryas, and pigs, figures 12-5 through 12-9. Extension of this infection into the cranial cavity is common when this ear infection is not treated vigorously, and the results of the extension may be lethal. Three anatomic routes for infection may be used to obtain access to the tympanic cavity. 1. From otitis externa. 2. From nasopharyngeal infections extending through the auditory tube. And 3. Hematogenously from a bacteremia. Clinical signs may be acute or chronic in onset and progressive. The clinical signs of peripheral vestibular dysfunction are usually less severe than in dogs with a benign idiopathic disorder. Otitis may be bilateral, but the neurologic signs are unilateral. Otoscopic examination may show changes in the middle ear cavity with the tympanic membrane ruptured or still intact. However, otitis media is often undetected with this procedure, and imaging is required for the diagnosis. For years, we have relied on radiography, but both computed tomography, CT, and MRI are more reliable. CT is better than MRI to show the degree of bone involvement. However, MRI allows better detection of fluid in the tympanic cavity, changes in the cochlea, and involvement of the medulla, see figure 12-6. Ideally, treatment should be based on isolation of the infectious agent and the use of specific antibacterial or antifungal drugs to which the agent is most susceptible. Remember to avoid the aminoglycoside antibiotics that are ototoxic. Surgery may be required for severe or chronic cases. Neoplasms occasionally involve the tympanic and petrous portions of the temporal bone. They often arise from the tissues of the external ear canal and invade the temporal bone, but primary bone neoplasms occur as well. Figure 12-10. The anatomic diagnosis might well be identical to that in this dog, as the neoplasm expands medially, brainstem or cerebellar compression or both, will result with corresponding clinical signs. Diagnosis is dependent on adequate imaging procedures. Squamous cell carcinoma is a common neoplasm that involves the ear of cats. Polycranial neuritis is a diagnosis of exclusion and is made when all ancillary studies are normal. Radiography diagnosed otitis media in Bozo, and recovery followed antibiotic therapy. Case example 12-3 Signalment, 5.5-year-old female Chesapeake Bay Retriever, Splash chief complaint, head tilt, facial deformity and depression history. 1 year before this examination, the owner noticed that Splash had a slight right head tilt. The dog also tended to drool excessively from the right side of her mouth. 1 month before this examination, The owner noted that the right eye was sunken, and the head appeared to be deformed. For the 2 to 3 weeks before the examination, Splash was depressed and would occasionally stagger and fall. Examination. See video 12-6. If you noted a normal gait, you should have appreciated that the hopping responses on the right side were consistently delayed and lacked the smooth quality seen with the left limbs. Poor placement was normal. Note the absent right palpebral reflex but intact facial sensation. The elevated right ear with what we thought was increased tone in the right lips, and a very slight deviation of the philtrum to the right. Note the lack of temporal and masseter muscle mass on the right side. Splash resisted having her mouth opened, and a mass lesion was palpated on the right side between the transverse process of the atlas and the caudal portion of the mandible. A persistent anisocoria, not seen in the video, was observed, with the right pupil always smaller than the left and an abnormal positional nystagmus when Splash was placed on her back. This nystagmus was vertical or directed to the right side. Anatomic diagnosis. Right pons or medulla or both, right facial neurons, right vestibular system, right motor neurons of the trigeminal nerve, right UMN, GP systems in the pons or medulla or both. At the time of this examination, the right facial paralysis observed in this dog was associated with facial tetanus. Presumably, the initial clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction involved the peripheral components, but this presumption could not be proved. At the time of this examination, clinical signs of involvement of the UMN and GP systems were noted, most likely in the pons or medulla or both, which might also affect the vestibular nuclei. The masticatory muscle atrophy implicates the mandibular nerve branch of the trigeminal nerve or motor nucleus of 5 in the pons. Otitis media interna will not affect the trigeminal nerve or its ganglion where it passes through the canal for the trigeminal nerve in the rostral portion of the petrous part of the temporal bone. The thick portion of this bone that separates the tympanic cavity and this nerve prevents this occurrence. However, an erosive neoplasm in the temporal bone knows no boundaries. Presumably, this dog is deaf on her right side, but we cannot determine this loss of function in our physical neurologic examination. Differential diagnosis: neoplasm, intraparenchymal or extraparenchymal, abscess, granuloma secondary to otitis media interna, focal encephalitis, granulomatous meningoencephalitis, fungal meningoencephalitis, neoplasm based on the 1-year history of very slow progression of clinical signs and the palpation of a mass lesion in the area of the anatomic diagnosis. A neoplasm is the most likely clinical diagnosis. Radiography determined that a large mass had obliterated most components of the right temporal bone. Splash was euthanized and had autopsy. This extraparenchymal temporal bone neoplasm was diagnosed as a basal cell carcinoma, figures 12-11 through 12-14. Case example 12-4 signalment. 6-year-old spayed female golden retriever, Courtney chief complaint, difficulty walking and frequent falling history. 3 days before examination, the owner first recognized clinical signs when Courtney fell down the stairs and had difficulty maintaining her balance. The owner blamed the fall as the cause of an injury. However, Courtney developed a left head tilt, and her difficulty with walking progressively worsened. Be aware that neurologic signs associated with a fall are usually the cause of the fall and not the result of it, despite what the owners believe. Examination. See video 12-7. Note Courtney's strong tendency to lean in circle to her left side and the right side hypermetria with excessive limb flexion most evident in the thoracic limb. The abnormal positional nystagmus was mostly vertical but occasionally rotatory left or right. Anatomic diagnosis. Right cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The quality of the hypermetria represents a cerebellar dysfunction based on the excessive flexion of the limb on protraction. In the overreaching form of hypermetria that was described with cervical spinal cord disorders, the thoracic limb is in extension when protracted. See the description of video 12-8 at the end of this case example. The slow hopping and hammer walking with the right limb supports the central nervous system, CNS, lesion involving the right UMN or GP systems or both, in the caudal brainstem or the right side of the cerebellum. The head tilt and loss of balance are directed to the left, which suggests clinical signs of a paradoxical vestibular system disorder, unless multifocal lesions such as right cerebellum and left vestibular nuclei are present. The clinical signs of a vestibular system disorder are profound. The quality of the gait abnormality, the deficit in postural reactions, and the abnormal nystagmus that change direction with different head positions all support that the vestibular system involvement is in its central components. These findings indicate central vestibular disease unequivocally. Differential diagnosis: neoplasm, inflammation, vascular compromise, malformation, toxicity, hypothyroidism, neoplasm on the basis of the progressive nature of the clinical signs. Neoplasia and focal inflammation are the two most common clinical disorders for consideration in this patient. Neoplasms in the caudal cranial fossa include intraparenchymal glioma, medulloblastoma, primitive neuroectodermal tumor, choroid plexus papilloma or carcinoma, ependymoma, and extraparenchymal meningioma. Granulomatous meningoencephalitis. The most common focal encephalitis to occur in this area of the brain is granulomatous meningoencephalitis, GME. GME is usually classified as a non-infectious disorder. The pathogenesis of this disorder is not well understood but is presently considered a form of lymphoproliferative disorder that may evolve into a lymphoma. An autoimmune disease has also been proposed. GME tends to be more common in young adult small to medium-sized breeds, but any breed at any age may be affected. The angiocentric lesions predominate in white matter and may be diffusely distributed through the brain and spinal cord, occur in multifocal sites, or be primarily located at one site while the paravascular and parenchymal proliferation of lymphoplasmacytic cells and macrophages, histiocytes, may be so extensive as to cause a mass lesion. Lesions in the cerebellum, pons, and medulla are common. A localized form is thought to occur in the optic nerves, causing an optic neuritis. Optic neuritis is described in Chapter 14 on the visual system. CSF usually reflects a lesion with marked elevation of protein and non-suppurative inflammatory cells. MRI is the preferred procedure to demonstrate these lesions, especially when they are focal. These lesions are hyperintense on T2-weighted and fluid-attenuated inversion recovery, flare, images. Contrast enhancement is response variable. Immunosuppressive drugs such as prednisone or oral cyclosporin, or a variety of chemotherapeutic agents, lomustine, cytosine arabinoside, azathioprine, may be effective at slowing or stopping the progression of the disease and alleviating some of the clinical signs. Focal lesions may be treated with radiation therapy, but responses to these treatments vary. Remember that this anatomic site is at risk for developing an abscess or more diffuse suppurative meningoencephalitis associated with extension of an infection from the middle and inner ear. Vascular compromise causing ischemia or infarction are common in the cerebellum and are usually asymmetric, affecting part or all of one hemisphere and the ipsilateral half of the vermis. The clinical signs may be very similar to those seen in Courtney. See the examples in Chapter 13 on the cerebellum. However, the clinical signs should be acute in onset and not progress over more than 24 hours as a rule. Malformation was included in the differential diagnosis because the caudal cranial fossa is a common site for epidermoid or dermoid cysts to occur. These cysts are thought to be developmental in origin and result from an abnormality when the neural tube folds and closes in this area and separates from the overlying ectoderm. The epithelial lining of these cysts proliferates and secretes, causing the cyst to enlarge and, in time, produce clinical signs from its mass effect. Metronidazole toxicity causes severe clinical signs of dysfunction in the components of the caudal cranial fossa, but these are usually symmetric and require a history of exposure to this drug. Hypothyroidism has been associated in adult dogs with an acute onset of persistent or progressive clinical signs of a caudal cranial fossa lesion that included involvement of the central components of the vestibular system. In this study, thyroid function evaluations were abnormal and all the animals responded to treatment with levothyroxine. The pathogenesis of the disorder is unknown, although atherosclerosis was suggested in earlier studies. MRI was performed on Courtney and revealed a mass lesion on the right side of the caudal cranial fossa, primarily within the right cerebellar hemisphere and the vermis. See video. This finding was interpreted to be an intraparenchymal neoplasm, most likely a glioma. She was euthanized, and no autopsy was performed. Video 12-8 shows Arnie, a 4-year-old bull mastiff with a history of 4 to 5 generalized seizures over the previous 3 weeks and 3 days of a head tilt and abnormal gait. Note the right head tilt and drifting to his right side and the overreaching of the left thoracic limb with the limb in extension. This form of hypermetria contrasts with that observed in Courtney in video 12-7. The prolonged protraction with the limb in extension is a clinical sign of UMN or GP system disorder, or both. Not seen on the video were the slow hopping responses in the left limbs of Arnie and the abnormal positional nystagmus that change directions in different positions of the head. The anatomic diagnosis includes prosencephalon, left cerebellum, pons, and medulla. Seizures are caused by disorders that involve some portion of the prosencephalon. The left UMN, GP system disorder may be present anywhere from the pons through the first to fifth cervical spinal cord segments on the left side. The vestibular system signs are from a CNS lesion that is most likely in the left cerebellum, and these signs are paradoxical vestibular signs. Multifocal lesions are usually either inflammatory or neoplastic. CSF was normal. MRI revealed a small hyperintense lesion in the left diencephalon and a large hyperintense lesion in the left cerebellar hemisphere and vermis in the left dorsolateral medulla. See the video for the MR images of the cerebellar lesion. In these images, the axial sections alternate between the T2 weighted and proton density images. The spinal cord was not imaged. Arnie's clinical signs progressed over the next 2 weeks, and he was euthanized. An autopsy was performed, and the hyperintense areas seen on MRI were consistent with an astrocytoma. Case example 12-5 signalment. 9-year-old spayed female border collie, Mercy. Chief complaint, head tilt history. Mercy was presented to Cornell 10 days after an acute onset of inability to stand, thrashing attempts to stand, and episodes of neck and thoracic limb extension. Over these 10 days, she improved remarkably but still had a mild head tilt. Examination. See video 12-9. Note the mild left head tilt, her tendency to drift to the right side, and the slow hopping responses in the right limbs when tested repeatedly. No abnormal nystagmus was noted. Anatomic diagnosis. The right side of the cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The head tilt was assumed to be a paradoxical vestibular sign. Differential diagnosis. Neoplasm. Inflammation. Vascular compromise. Malformation. Toxicity. Ischemic encephalopathy. These differential diagnoses are the same as those listed for Courtney in case example 12-4. However, the acute non-traumatic onset and the steady improvement up to the time of this examination strongly indicated a vascular compromise with ischemic lesions, which were resolving. 1 week later, Mercy was examined by Dr. Eric Glass and no neurologic deficits were found. MRI was normal at this time. These findings indicate a presumptive unilateral cerebellar vascular compromise with ischemia, which completely resolved. The cause of the vascular compromise is unknown. See Chapter 13 for further description and examples of this disorder. Signalment. 6-year-old spayed female papillon, Dolly. Chief complaint, inability to stand. History. Over a few days, Dolly had progressed from difficulty walking, to difficulty trying to stand, to tremors of her head. Examination. See video 12-10. Note the loss of balance with swaying of the body to either side, the difficulty in initiating limb movements, the tendency to assume an episiotonic posture of the head and neck, the limb hypertonia, the resting vertical nystagmus, and her appearance of disorientation. Anatomic diagnosis. Cerebellum, pons, and medulla. These clinical signs are often loosely termed cerebellar vestibular signs, with the latter being a product of involvement of the central components of the vestibular system. They are usually accompanied by some degree of UMN and GP system dysfunction. Head and neck tremors occur with cerebellar disorders. The absolutely vertical nystagmus, in combination with the other neurologic signs, supports a disorder of the central vestibular system components. Differential diagnosis. Neoplasm. Inflammation. Vascular compromise. Malformation. Toxicity. Metronidazole toxicity. These diagnoses are the same as those listed for case examples 12-4 and 12-5. The severity of these clinical signs, their symmetric nature, and the persistent resting abnormal nystagmus are strongly suggestive of metronidazole toxicity. On questioning Dolly's owner about possible exposure to this drug, we were informed that Dolly had been receiving this drug for 1 month as a treatment for pancreatitis. Further inquiry determined that Dolly was receiving approximately twice the recommended dose of metronidazole. Be aware that dogs that receive recommended doses of this drug are also at risk for this toxicity, especially if liver or kidney insufficiency exists, as the drug is metabolized and excreted by these organs. As a rule, however, the greatest risk for dogs to develop clinical signs of toxicity occurs when the drug is administered for long periods and especially at excessive doses. We have also seen cats with this toxicity. Case example 12-7 Signalment. 9-month-old female Labrador Retriever, Roxy chief complaint, difficulty standing and frequent falls history. An abnormal gait was first observed at approximately 7 months of age. This phase slowly progressed to difficulty standing and falling to either side, which the owner described as a drunken gait. Roxy also developed fine tremors of her entire body. The owner described that these clinical signs tended to wax and wane in severity during the day. Examination. See video 12-11. Note the similarity of these clinical signs to those in case example 12-6. See video 12-10, with the poor initiation of limb movements associated with sudden bursts of activity, the inability to coordinate standing, the episodes of opus, bottonus with thoracic limb rigidity, and the fine tremor of the entire body, including the limbs. No abnormal nystagmus was noted, and the dog acted alert and responsive. Note the last portion of the video when the dog is urged to come out of her cage, which occurred approximately 1 hour after the first portion of the video, during which time the dog was resting in this cage. Note her ability to stand and walk here a bit with marked difficulty. Roxy was hospitalized the day before this examination, and she was observed to have a generalized seizure in her cage that lasted approximately 1 minute. Anatomic diagnosis. Diffuse CNS with a major component involving the cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The clinical signs observed on the video relate to dysfunction in the cerebellum, pons, and medulla similar to Dolly in case example 12-6. However, seizures are related to a disorder of some component of the prosencephalon, and the fine whole body tremors require a diffuse disorder of myelin or axons in the entire CNS. Differential diagnosis. Degeneration, toxicity, inflammation, leukodystrophy. The slow progression of symmetric clinical signs and the lack of any exposure to a known toxin make toxicity and inflammation less likely. In cases such as this one, remember to look at the breed and ask yourself if any recognized inherited degenerative disorder is described for this breed that causes similar clinical signs. When you search for these data in your textbooks or on the internet, you will find that the answer is yes. In 1975, Dr. Jack McGraw at the University of Pennsylvania described a fibrinoid encephalomyelopathy, Alexander disease, in 2 8-month-old littermate Labrador retrievers with clinical signs of a diffuse CNS disorder. This degeneration is a disorder of astrocytes. It is associated with loss of myelin, especially in the cerebral white matter. Thus, this disease is also known as leukodystrophy. The abnormal astrocytes are widely distributed in the CNS, but their perivascular density and the myelin loss in the cerebral white matter will appear as a diffuse bilaterally symmetric hyperintensity in T2 weighted and proton density MR images. In 1985, Dr. Dennis O'Brien described a spongy degeneration of CNS white matter, a leukodystrophy, in Labrador retrievers. The onset of clinical signs for the dogs in this report was 4 to 6 months of age. The lesion consists of a separation of the myelin lamellae, causing a dilation of the myelin sheath due to the accumulation of fluid between lamellae, known as myelin edema. It is found throughout the CNS and is especially prominent where large bundles of white matter are found, such as the spinal cord, cerebellar medial area and foveal white matter, internal capsule, centrum semiovale, and corona radiata. These lesions are hypointense on T1 weighted MR images and hyperintense on the T2 weighted images. An autosomal recessive gene inheritance is presumed but is not yet proven. Roxy had a littermate that had been euthanized at 4 months of age for generalized seizures, but no autopsy had been performed. Roxy was euthanized, and an autopsy confirmed the diagnosis of leukodystrophy similar to that described by O'Brien. Case example 12-8 Signalment. 3-year-old castrated male domestic short hair, Ruben chief complaint, head tilt and loss of balance history. One late July evening, Ruben's owner let him outdoors for the evening and found him in the morning on the back steps with a head tilt and difficulty walking. Ruben was brought to the hospital that day, and the video was made the next morning. Examination. See video 12-12. Note how alert this cat is. Note also his normal quick limb movements as he attempts to maintain his balance. He staggers to either side but more often to the left, which is the side of his head tilt and head turn. In the first portion of the video, when he looks to the left, note the brief head rotations. These movements correspond to the resting right nystagmus that is present. When you perform the hopping responses in cats, many of them will simply roll over and not respond at all. To prevent this result, hold the cat up and grasp the three limbs that you are not testing, and quickly lower the cat to the ground, extending the limb to be hopped. As soon as the limb strikes the ground, move the cat laterally on it, and the normal cat will at least give you a few hops before rolling over. Note the elevation of the tail, which is typical of cats with severe balance loss. Anatomic diagnosis. Left peripheral vestibular system components. Differential diagnosis. Benign idiopathic feline peripheral vestibular disease, otitis media interna, ototoxicity. Benign idiopathic feline peripheral vestibular disease. Benign idiopathic feline peripheral vestibular disease is the most presumptive clinical diagnosis based on the sudden onset of severe clinical signs of peripheral vestibular system dysfunction with no involvement of the facial nerve or ganglionic sympathetic nerves in the late summer in a young adult cat with access to the outdoors. The cause of this disease is unknown. See the previous discussion of the similar benign idiopathic canine disorder and polycranial neuritis. Because this disease in cats occurs at the same time of year as the acute onset brain disease caused by the miasis of the larva of Acaridae sp, some neurologists have hypothesized that this peripheral vestibular syndrome is caused by the migration of this larva in the middle and inner ear. However, no definitive proof of this has been found. No Acaridae sp larvae have been found in any part of the ear of a cat with or without these clinical signs, and the few autopsies that included study of the inner ear structures have not found a recognizable lesion. Investigators have reported that this disease may occur in cats that have no access to the outdoors, but these reports are rare. The high incidence of this disorder from late July through September in outdoor cats implies some environmental factor, for example, insect toxin, toxic spray, plant pollen, that may cause ototoxicity. This factor is unknown. The clinical signs are per acute and onset and typical for a severe dysfunction of the peripheral vestibular system. Although the clinical signs predominate to one side, a bilateral disturbance is suggested by the occasional wide head excursions to either side and the tendency of the cat to stagger in both directions. Fortunately, most of these cats recover spontaneously. However, often the recovery is slower than that observed with dogs with benign idiopathic peripheral vestibular disease. Their vestibular ataxia improves greatly by 7 to 10 days, and the head tilt tilt usually resolves by 2 to 4 weeks. Occasionally, a residual head tilt persists. Even recovered cats may exhibit a slight head tilt and balance loss if they are significantly stressed. Without more knowledge of the cause of the pathogenesis of this disorder and the spontaneous recovery, treatment of these cats is not justified. However, the use of antibiotics is rational as a treatment for a possible otitis, which is the other most common cause of these clinical signs. These cats must be kept in a protected environment while they recover. Rarely does this disorder occur in cats, which is unlike the canine disorder. Experimental surgical ablation of the inner ear of a cat will cause similar clinical signs, including recovery by cerebellomedullary compensation. This disease represents just another of many reasons to keep cats indoors. Otitis media interna. Otitis media interna is your other most significant concern for a disorder that would cause this anatomic diagnosis. The presence of a facial paresis or Horner syndrome would be supportive of this diagnosis of otitis because these conditions never occur with the benign disorder just described. Usually, the initial clinical signs of peripheral vestibular system dysfunction are not so severe with otitis, but an otoscopic examination should be performed on all of these cats. The most reliable way to diagnose otitis is with imaging, but when presented with a cat such as Ruben in this case example, we would delay imaging unless the patient's recovery was not satisfactory, or a history of otitis externa was present. Ototoxicity obviously requires a history of drug exposure. Video 12-13 shows a 4-year-old spayed female domestic short hair with a sudden onset of the clinical signs observed on this video. You should appreciate that all of these clinical signs represent dysfunction in the peripheral components of the vestibular system. The resting right rotatory nystagmus is not shown on the video. Note that although the clinical signs are asymmetric with the left head tilt and leaning to the left, this cat has some indication of bilateral dysfunction with a tendency to stagger to either side and the uncontrolled head and neck movements in both directions. This presumptive diagnosis is benign idiopathic feline peripheral vestibular disease. Video 12-14 shows Socks, a 6-month-old castrated male domestic tick short hair with a sudden onset of the abnormal gait and posture, as seen on this video. Your anatomic diagnosis should be right peripheral vestibular system components and left sympathetic innervation to the eye. This finding suggests a bilateral otitis media with the inner ear involved on the right side. Case example 12-9 Signalment, 2-year-old female domestic short hair, 0 chief complaint, abnormal head movements history. 2 months before this examination, 0 was presented to a veterinarian for sudden onset of a right head tilt and balance loss. These signs were diagnosed as a right peripheral vestibular system disorder. Evidence of right otitis externa was also found. During the next week, the clinical signs progressed to a bilateral loss of balance and what the referring veterinarian described as a head bob. The head bob and a mild ataxia had persisted and changed up to the time of this examination. Examination, see video 12-15. Note the wide head excursions with the inability to stop the head movements to either side. No abnormal nystagmus, normal physiologic nystagmus, or postrotatory nystagmus could be generated. This cat was also deaf. Anatomic diagnosis, bilateral peripheral vestibular and cochlear components, cranial nerve 8. The bilateral, wide, and uncontrolled head excursions are typical of bilateral peripheral vestibular disease. When the inner ear is affected by a disease process bilaterally, deafness may be recognized on your physical neurologic examination. Differential diagnosis, otitis media interna, ototoxicity bilateral otitis media interna. In our experience, bilateral otitis involving the inner ear has been the only clinical condition that causes these clinical signs of acquired bilateral peripheral vestibular system dysfunction. The benign idiopathic disorder may cause bilateral clinical signs, but some asymmetry is most often seen. Radiography demonstrated extensive bilateral changes diagnostic of otitis media. Despite antibiotic therapy and bilateral osteotomy, Zero's clinical signs remained unchanged. See the following videos of other cats with bilateral otitis media interna and clinical signs of bilateral peripheral vestibular nerve and cochlear nerve dysfunction. Video 12-16 shows Fractal, a 12-year-old castrated male domestic short hair, who was anesthetized for surgical treatment of an oral hematoma. While still under anesthesia, both ears were flushed despite no indication of any otitis externa. Be aware that ear flushing procedures may cause complications and should be avoided unless absolutely necessary. On recovery from anesthesia, Fractal exhibited the clinical signs that you see on this video. Fractal did not startle even with rigorous banging of pans together to create a loud noise behind his head, and electrophysiologic testing, brainstem auditory evoked response, BAR, showed no ability to stimulate a response in the cochlear nerves bilaterally. Ear flushing of any kind may result in what you have seen here despite any indication of pre-existing otitis externa. You cannot assess the tympanum for its barrier function, and small perforations may not be recognized. Video 12-17 shows Magnum, an 8-year-old domestic short hair with bilateral otitis media interna. Video 12-18 shows a 10-week-old female domestic short hair with a 1-week history of losing her balance and what the owner described as rolling eyes. 2 days before this video was made, this kitten began to exhibit wide head excursions. Otitis media interna was diagnosed in each ear. Treatment for otitis requires long-term oral antibiotics. Surgery is sometimes necessary, especially when the otitis is associated with polyp formation. Corticosteroids should definitely be avoided. We have seen numerous cases of otitis that have been treated with long-term corticosteroids, which, secondary to immunosuppression, resulted in an abscess of the petrous portion of the temporal bone and eventual compression of the medulla and pons. Congenital peripheral vestibular system disease. Be aware that clinical signs of a peripheral vestibular system disorder are occasionally present at birth or are at least apparent as soon as the affected animal begins to move around and tries to stand and walk. These clinical signs are unilateral or bilateral and often affect both the vestibular nerve and the cochlear nerve or their labyrinthine receptors in the membranous labyrinth. It is not known whether the vestibular system lesions are malformative or an early onset abiotrophy. This lesion has been observed in many breeds of small animals with no proof of the presumed inheritance of the disorder. These breeds include the German Shepherd Dog, 50 Doberman Pinscher, Akita, Beagle, English Cocker Spaniel, 3 Imbermese and Siamese cats. Some of these affected animals improve or even recover in time, presumably from compensation by vestibular system components in the CNS. No microscopic lesions have been recognized in the inner ears of patients that I have studied, but mild lesions of degeneration such as an amyotrophy are difficult to recognize after the process of decalcification of the bony labyrinth within the petrous part of the temporal bone that is required to prepare tissue sections for study. A lymphocytic labyrinthitis was described in two related litters of Doberman Pinscher puppies. Signalment: 12-year-old spayed female domestic short hair, Peppy chief complaint, head tilt and severe balance loss history. 6 weeks before this examination, Peppy was examined for a head tilt and mild loss of balance. Otitis media interna was diagnosed and treated with antibiotics. Despite 1 month of this therapy, her clinical signs worsened. Examination: see video 12-19. Study the severe clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction and determine whether the involvement of this system is central or peripheral or both. Anatomic diagnosis: cerebellum, pons, and medulla. Sympathetic innervation to the head. You should have recognized the episodes of opisthotonus and extensor muscle rigidity in the limbs and trunk. The amperesis and GP ataxia in the limbs that was worse on the left side. The left facial paralysis, left facial hypalgesia, and the left sympathetic paresis. The last of these signs suggests that in addition to the caudal cranial fossa brain lesion, a left middle ear lesion is present or that one disorder affects all of these structures. The latter diagnosis is suspected based on the palpable mass shown at the end of the video on the left side and the angle between the mandible and the transverse process of the atlas. Normally, you should be able to place your finger in a groove between these two structures as on the right side in this cat. Differential diagnosis: neoplasm, inflammation, abscess, neoplasm on the basis of the assumption that the palpable mass near the area of the anatomic diagnosis is responsible for the clinical signs. A neoplasm or unusually large abscess or granuloma is the most likely clinical diagnosis. Radiography suggested an aggressive neoplasm, with involvement of all portions of the left temporal bone that compress the CNS components in the caudal cranial fossa on the left side. Figures 12-15 and 12-16. Peppy was euthanized, and autopsy confirmed this clinical diagnosis. The neoplasm was identified as a squamous cell carcinoma, figures 12-17 and 12-18. Cucurbita larvomyosis video 12-20 shows a 1-year-old female domestic short hair living on a farm in western New York State. 3 days before this video was made, she rapidly lost the ability to stand and began to roll to the right side. These signs, as well as the right hemiplegia, can be seen on the video. She had a resting right or vertical nystagmus. Remember that persistent rolling is a clinical sign usually related to dysfunction of the central vestibular system components. The anatomic diagnosis is cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The most likely differential diagnosis for this 1-year-old cat would include three disorders. 1. Inflammation caused by the feline infectious peritonitis, FIP, virus or the protozoal agent Toxoplasma gondii. FIP encephalitis is the most common infection at this site. 2. Miasis of a larva of the Caudari Brouwerspia fly, and 3. An abscess or suppurative meningoencephalitis secondary to otitis media interna. CSF contained 89 mg per deciliter, mgdl, of protein, normal, 20, and 289 white blood cells, WBCs, per cubic millimeter, mm3, that were predominantly neutrophils. This finding supports an inflammation that might relate to any one of these three disorders. This cat was euthanized, and an autopsy confirmed extensive larval migration, with the dead larva found in the vermis of the cerebellum. The larva was presumed to belong to a species of Caudari Brouwer. Figures 12-19 and 12-20. Caudari SP miasis is described in detail in Chapter 14. Case example 12-11. Signalment: 8-month-old male Siamese chief complaint, inability to get up history. 3 months before this examination, this cat developed a gait abnormality in his pelvic limbs that slowly progressed to the thoracic limbs and involved some apparent loss of balance. For the previous few days, he had been unable to stand. During these 3 months, he was examined by the local veterinarian for numerous episodes of depression associated with a chronic fever. Examination: see video 12-21. Note the disparity in voluntary movements between the thoracic and pelvic limbs. Not shown was an abnormal vertical to horizontal left positional nystagmus. Anatomic diagnosis: diffuse or multifocal, including the cerebellum, pons, and medulla in the central portion of spinal cord segments C1 to C5. The history of balance loss and the persistent abnormal postsessional nystagmus indicates involvement of the vestibular system. The decerebellar posture, figure 12-21, indicates a caudal cranial fossa lesion. The tetraparesis and ataxia of all four limbs implicates dysfunction of the UMN and GP systems anywhere from the pons to the C5 spinal cord segment, with possible lesions caudal to this area as well. The more severe UMN paresis in the thoracic limbs indicates that if the lesion involves the C1, C5 spinal cord segments, the lesions are more centrally located in these segments. Differential diagnosis: encephalomyelitis FIP virus, T. gondii, Cryptococcus neoformans, abscess or bacterial or fungal suppurative meningoencephalitis, Caudari larvomyosis, lymphosarcoma, new, Ronal storage disease, feline infectious peritonitis, viral meningoencephalitis and inflammatory disease is the most presumptive clinical diagnosis based on the episodes of fever. Infection with the coronavirus that causes an exudative peritonitis in cats is termed feline infectious peritonitis. Many of these cats that have an exudative peritonitis also have a mild subclinical meningitis. A few cats develop an extensive chronic FIP viral meningoencephalomyelitis with profound neurologic signs and minimal peritonitis. FIP viral meningoencephalomyelitis is, by far, the most common infectious disease of the CNS in cats, especially young cats. This abnormality is primarily a surface-oriented disease, which means that the leptomeninges on the external surface of the brain and spinal cord are affected, and the internal ependymal line ventricular system is also affected. The latter area includes the choroid plexuses and the central canal of the spinal cord. This disease is an immunopathologic disorder that involves an immune complex-induced vasculitis. The virus may be found in macrophages in the lesion. The degree of accumulation of inflammatory cells may be extensive enough to be seen on gross examination of the CNS, as well as on MRI. Although clinical signs may reflect involvement by this lesion at any level of the CNS, they often relate to the lesions in the area of the cerebellum, pons, and medulla, known as the caudal cranial fossa. One study reported pelvic lymphoresis, abnormal nystagmus, and seizures as the most common clinical signs observed with this disease. Uveitis may also accompany the neurologic disorder. Clinical signs are slowly progressive and often include partial anorexia and a fever that are unresponsive to antibiotic therapy. The globulin fraction of serum protein is often elevated, and CSF often is very abnormal, with protein levels even as high as 0.5 to 1.0 GDL, normal, 20 mg/dL, and hundreds of WBCs MM3 that vary from all mononuclear cells to a high percentage of neutrophils. Serum antibodies against this virus are usually, but not always, present in these cats. However, these antibodies are not specific for this virus but rather for the group of coronaviruses. This disease cannot be differentiated from toxoplasmosis or cryptococcosis based on the neurologic signs alone. The persistent fever is more typical of amphiviral infection. As a rule, serum antibodies will be present in cats with toxoplasmosis, and an antigen test will detect cryptococcal organisms in serum or CSF. Cryptococcal fungal organisms are usually evident in the cytologic examination of CSF. Cats with an extension of infection from the middle and inner ear may produce evidence of this ear infection on your physical examination and should have recognizable temporal bone lesions on imaging studies. Cutaribromyosis is less likely to cause such a slow progression of neurologic signs or the persistent fever. In addition, cutaribromyosis is seasonal. Lymphosarcoma most commonly causes an extradural focal compression of the spinal cord but is occasionally within the parenchyma and diffusely distributed through the CNS, primarily in the meninges and the perivascular spaces within the CNS. CSF changes would be expected to be mild and may include lymphocytes, lymphoblasts, or both. Many forms of neuronal storage diseases have been recognized in cats that cause slowly progressive diffuse neurologic signs of CNS dysfunction. Diffuse repetitive myoclonus, tremor, related to whole body action is often present with storage diseases along with primarily prosencephalic signs of loss of vision, change in behavior, and seizures. Fevers do not typically occur in storage disorders. In the cat in this case example, CSF contained 498 mg/dL of protein and 1,144 WBCs MM3, which were all lymphocytes or monocytes. These findings supported amphiviral-induced inflammation. The cat was euthanized, and had autopsy, a very extensive leptomeningitis, choroid plexitis, ependymitis, and associated encephalitis, which were characteristic for an infection with the FIP virus, were observed. Figures 12-22 and 12-23, figures 12-24 through 12-27 are MR images from a 9-month-old domestic short hair with a progressive gait disorder that included central vestibular ataxia and episodes of opisthotonus and vertical nystagmus. MRI showed ependymal and meningeal enhancement that is typical of a lesion distribution of FIP viral meningoencephalitis. This was confirmed at autopsy. Thiamine deficiency encephalopathy. Be aware that an initial clinical sign of thiamine deficiency in small animals is usually vestibular ataxia. However, this phase is usually rapidly followed by pupillary dilation and generalized seizures. This condition was more common when cats were fed a fish diet that contained thiaminase. Cooking the animal's food will destroy the thiamine. It is also suspected that prolonged anorexia may lead to a thiamine deficiency that is sufficient to cause clinical signs. The bilateral symmetric degenerative lesions in the vestibular nuclei, caudal colliculi, nuclei of the oculomotor nerve, and lateral geniculate nuclei may be recognized on MR images. The unique anatomy of these lesions was observed on MRI in a dog, leading to a diagnosis of thiamine deficiency of unknown cause. Prompt intramuscular injection of thiamine in the early stages of this clinical disorder may lead to complete recovery from this metabolic encephalopathy rather quickly. A rapid response supports a presumptive diagnosis. We typically use 50 mg intramuscularly twice a day for 3 to 5 days for the treatment of thiamine deficiency in cats. Case example 12-12 Signalment. 4-year-old thoroughbred Trachner gelding chief complaint, right head deviation and crooked face history. This horse was in training as a dressage horse for the U.S. Olympic team. In the past 3 weeks, the horse had displayed a slight head deviation to the right and a tendency to drift to the right. A deviation of the nose to the left had been noted 4 days earlier. Examination. See video 12-22. Note the method of blindfolding this horse and the exacerbation of the ataxia when this was performed. Anatomic diagnosis. Right peripheral vestibular system and facial nerve. You should have noted the normal strength and limb placement that this horse exhibits. This horse clearly knows where his limbs are located and initiates a normal rapid protraction of all of his limbs. Differential diagnosis. Otitis media interna, temporal hyoid osteopathy, and temporal bone fracture. Otitis media interna. These findings are the classical clinical signs of dysfunction of the vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8 and cranial nerve 7, which, in all species, most commonly relate to a middle ear and inner ear infection. We have not seen a neoplasm of the temporal bone or a neoplasm of these cranial nerves in the horse. However, a nerve sheath tumor of the vestibulocochlear nerve has been reported in the dog. Temporal hyoid osteopathy. A unique bone disorder often accompanies this otitis in horses. This abnormality is a temporal hyoid osteopathy, which involves an ankylosis of this joint associated with a proliferation of the long stylohyoid bone and probably the very small tympanohyoid by which it articulates with a petrous portion of the temporal bone. This circumstance results in a fusion of these bones at the level of the tympanic portion of the temporal bone. This bony proliferation envelopes the tympanic portion of the temporal bone but does not invade the tympanic cavity. See figure 6-43. With this loss of mobility of the hyoid apparatus, a risk of fracture of the petrous portion of the temporal bone exists. The assumption is that the otitis precedes and induces the osteopathy, but no proof of this has been found. The few microscopic studies on the osteopathy have never shown any indication of an osteomyelitis. The cause of this bone lesion remains unknown and has not been observed in other species. The lesion is unrelated to any disease within the guttural pouch. The assumption is that the ankylosis is secondary to the otitis media interna, and the extensive enlargement of the stylohyoid bone is secondary to the immobility of this joint, which prevents normal remodeling of the bone. In some horses, the onset of clinical signs of vestibular nerve dysfunction and the facial paralysis are sudden and thought to be caused by the temporal bone fracture, especially in the few horses that exhibit a brief period of partial dysphagia from presumed involvement of cranial nerves 9 and 10 of the jugular foramen. The latter development cannot be caused by the otitis alone. Whether otitis was present in these horses before the fracture is unknown. Occasionally, the bone lesion is bilateral, but the neurologic signs have always been unilateral. Radiography will reveal the enlarged stylohyoid bone with fusion to the temporal bone, but this circumstance prevents evaluation of the middle ear cavity. Ventrodorsal radiography is the most reliable view to observe this bone lesion but requires general anesthesia. Although CT is the preferred modality to diagnose this disorder and may reveal the fracture when it is present, general anesthesia is required. The enlargement of the stylohyoid bone, as well as the lack of movement at the temporohyoid articulation, may be seen through the wall of the guttural pouch on endoscopic examination. Video 12-23 shows an endoscopic examination of the guttural pouch of another adult horse that has a left side stylohyoid osteopathy. The first portion of the video shows the left guttural pouch with the enlarged caudal portion of the stylohyoid bone and the lack of any movement at its articulation with the temporal bone. The last portion of the video shows the right guttural pouch with a normal stylohyoid bone. Note the movement of this bone at its articulation. You may suspect this abnormality during your physical examination when you press dorsally on the basohyoid bone and assess the range of motion of the hyoid apparatus, which depends on immobile tympanohyoid articulation. You will feel resistance in horses with this bone lesion and fusion at this articulation. To prevent a fracture related to this bony fusion, a portion of the affected stylohyoid bone is removed, or, more recently, the entire serratohyoid bone has been removed. The latter surgery is easier to perform and has fewer complications. The horse in this case example had endoscopic and radiographic evidence of the temporohyoid osteopathy. He was treated for many weeks with antibiotics, made a complete recovery, and was returned to training. Remember that this facial nerve lesion may interfere with tear production, as well as prevent eyelid closure, which places the patient at considerable risk for corneal ulceration, keratitis, or both. You must provide artificial tears for this patient. A temporary tarsography may also be employed. Video 12-24 shows an 11-year-old saddlebred gelding up 3 days before hospitalization when he suddenly experienced a severe loss of balance, with a left head tilt and a left ear droop and his nose deviated to the right side. The horse fell down, and for 3 days, he resisted any effort to get him to stand. The video was made on the third day shortly after he was helped to stand. He shows considerable limb trembling in the video, which we believe is related to his prolonged recumbency and muscle compression. Note how rapidly he moves his limbs to compensate for his balance loss. Your anatomic diagnosis should be left cranial nerve 7 and the left vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8. An enlarged stylohyoid bone was observed on endoscopic examination of the left guttural pouch. The assumption was that the sudden onset of these clinical signs was associated with a fracture of the petrous portion of the temporal bone. CT was not available to confirm this diagnosis at the time this horse was studied. Although this horse improved on antibiotic therapy, 2 weeks later, he suddenly had a recurrence of the clinical signs and went down again. The assumption was that without surgical interruption of the hyoid apparatus, another fracture had occurred. This horse was euthanized, and no autopsy was performed. Benign idiopathic peripheral vestibular disease. Video 12-25 shows a 15-year-old thoroughbred gelding with a per-acute onset of balance loss with a right head tilt and a resting rotatory left abnormal nystagmus. The video was made approximately 24 hours after the onset of these clinical signs. Your anatomic diagnosis should be right vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8. Your differential diagnosis should include otitis media interna, temporohyoid osteopathy and temporal bone fracture, and benign idiopathic peripheral vestibular disorder. The last of these diagnoses is considered the most presumptive because of the acute onset of clinical signs and the absence of any facial nerve deficits. We are not aware of any published report of this benign disorder in the horse. Radiography of the temporal and stylohyoid bones and guttural pouch endoscopy was normal. This horse spontaneously completely recovered in approximately a 3-day period. On the basis of this examination and the rapid resolution of the clinical signs, we presumed that this episode was a possible example of benign idiopathic equine peripheral vestibular disease. Signalment: 15-year-old standardbred mare chief complaint, abnormal gait history. 3 days before this examination, this mare suddenly appeared unstable and exhibited a left head tilt. Her unsteady gait worsened over the 3 days. Examination: see video 12-26. Anatomic diagnosis: cerebellum, pons, and medulla. If you compare the gait of this horse with that of the previously described 3 horses, you should recognize the significant loss of UMN and GP function in this horse that is not present in the others. This circumstance places the clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction in this horse within the central components of the vestibular system. The right nasal hypalgia is best explained by the lesion interrupting the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve within the pons or austral medulla. Differential diagnosis: equine protozoal encephalitis, viral encephalomyelitis caused by rabies virus, RV, West Nile virus, WNV, and Eastern equine virus, EVE, equine herpes virus 1, EHV1, vasculitis and encephalopathy, abscess. Neoplasm equine protozoal encephalitis. The most presumptive clinical diagnosis of a sudden onset and progression of clinical signs in this area of the brain is infection by Sarcocystis neurona. This disorder is described in Chapter 11. The short period of observation makes rabies and EV encephalomyelitis still strong contenders for this diagnosis, but the lack of any prosencephalic signs makes them less likely. The focal sign of facial hypalgia in the absence of any contralateral prosencephalic signs also makes these viral diseases unlikely. The focal nature and the level of the anatomic diagnosis and the continual progression of the clinical signs make EHV1 infection less likely. This anatomic diagnosis would be unusual for WNV infection. An abscess from extension of an otitis is unlikely with no initial clinical signs of otitis before the clinical signs of CNS involvement. Streptococcus equi abscesses are more common in foals and rare at this age. Focal neoplasms are uncommon in the CNS of horses. The horse in this case example had serum antibodies for S. neurona, which supports exposure to this infectious agent. CSF contained 51 mgdl protein, normal, 80, but 28 WBCs MM3 with 92% lymphocytes and 8% monocytes, which supports non-suppurative meningoencephalitis. Although caudal brain stem lesions caused by S. neurona have a fair prognosis when treated with antiprotozoal drugs, the owner of this horse elected euthanasia. At autopsy, extensive necrosis and non-suppurative inflammation were found in the pons and medulla associated with S. neurona organisms. See videos 12-27 through 12-30 for other examples of varying degree of dysfunction of the central components of the vestibular system with involvement of other systems in the medulla, pons, and cerebellum caused by a non-suppurative encephalitis as a result of infection with S. neurona. Video 12-27 shows a 5-year-old standardbred gelding, which, 10 days before this examination, was in training and unable to maintain his stride in the sulky, the cart used for harness racing, and drifted to his right side. The gait disorder progressed, and 3 days before this examination the trainer noted a facial asymmetry and a tendency for the horse to circle to his right. Study this video, note how much effort is needed to make him circle to his left, and as soon as I let up on the lead shank, he veers off to his right side. Note the mild thoracic limb hypermetria with flexion of the joints, which suggests involvement of the cerebellum. Also note the left facial paralysis and atrophy of the left muscles of mastication. Your anatomic diagnosis should be cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The differential diagnosis is the same as that described for the horse in this case example. The lack of any prosencephalic signs after 10 days makes EV encephalomyelitis unlikely. As a rule, RV encephalomyelitis will cause recumbency in approximately 4 days and death by 7 to 10 days. EHV1 infection causes an acute onset of clinical signs without progression after approximately 2 days. WNV encephalomyelitis is still a candidate during the summer months when exposure to the carrier mosquitoes occurs. However, protozoal encephalitis is still the most presumptive clinical diagnosis for this horse. This horse was euthanized, and autopsy confirmed the diagnosis of protozoal encephalitis in the cerebellum and caudal brainstem. Figures 12-28 and 12-29. Video 12-28 shows a 9-year-old standardbred gelding, which, for 4 weeks, had exhibited slight ataxia when he came out of his stall. He continued racing until 10 days before this examination when he was removed from racing competition because of his progressive gait disorder. Study the video. Note the left head tilt, which indicates a dysfunction in some portion of the vestibular system. Also note that his gait clearly indicates dysfunction of the UMN and GP systems. The left facial paralysis may have been caused by a lesion anywhere from the facial nucleus in the medulla to the stylomastoid foramen, where the facial nerve emerges from the facial canal and forms branches. Only a lesion in the pons and medulla can explain all of these clinical signs. This horse was treated for a presumptive S. neurona encephalitis. 1 month later, he was much improved but not well enough to return to racing. Video 12-29 shows a 7-year-old thoroughbred stallion, which, 10 days before this examination, had stumbled on coming out of the starting gate. His gait abnormality worsened over the subsequent 10 days. Study the video. Note that the gait disorder represents a dysfunction of the UMN and GP systems that might be at any level between the pons and the C5 spinal cord segment. The severe atrophy of the right muscles of mastication. Note the prominence of the right ramus of the mandible and facial crest indicates that at least part of this lesion is in the pons where the motor nucleus of 5 is located. The only recognized cause of unilateral atrophy of the muscles of mastication in the horse at this time is an infection with S. neurona with loss of these GSE neuronal cell bodies and replacement by astrocytes. No obvious clinical signs of vestibular system dysfunction are noted in this horse. This horse was treated for several weeks with antiprotozoal drugs and recovered his normal gait. This recovery is on the video when snow is seen in the background. Note the absence of recovery of the muscles of mastication because that lesion, involving the neuronal cell bodies, is permanent. Video 12-30 shows a 10-year-old Appaloosa mare, which had developed a right head tilt and leaned to the right 1 day after foaling. Her gait disorder progressed over the next 3 days before this examination. Study the video, and note her mild head tilt and tendency to lean and drift to her right side. However, note the marked clinical signs of dysfunction in the UMN and GP systems that cause her to scuff her hooves and stumble in either direction. She was euthanized, and autopsy confirmed the diagnosis of protozoal encephalitis in the caudal brainstem. Case example 12-14 signalment. 1-month-old female Holstein Sheep complained, head tilt history. For the previous few days, this calf has exhibited a mild head tilt and occasionally stumbled. Examination. See video 12-31. The examiner is demonstrating loss of tone in the left ear, eyelids, and lips. The left palpebral reflex was decreased, but nociception from the nasal septum was normal. Anatomic diagnosis. Left cranial nerve 7 in the vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8. Differential diagnosis. Otitis media interna is the only disease that can be considered in a calf with these clinical signs. As this disease is common in all young farm animals, as in dogs and cats, imaging studies will help confirm this diagnosis, with CT being the most reliable. See video 6-5 for an example of this disorder in another calf and a CT scan of a lesion. These patients should be treated rigorously with antibiotics to prevent extension of the suppurative inflammation into the cranial cavity. These patients with otitis media interna may exhibit only clinical signs of facial nerve paralysis or only clinical signs of peripheral vestibular system dysfunction. Otitis media interna in a calf. Video 12-32 shows two calves from the same farm. The smaller one is 2 months of age, and the larger one is 4 months of age. Both calves have shown clinical signs for approximately 10 days. The smaller calf is alert, responsive, and walks well, but you should recognize a head tilt and ear droop and make the anatomic diagnosis of a right facial, 7, and vestibular nerve, 8, dysfunction. You should make a presumptive clinical diagnosis of a right otitis media interna for this calf. This presumption was supported by radiography, which revealed this otitis. Otitis with intracranial abscess in a calf. The older calf is depressed and needs assistance to stand and holds its neck in an abnormal extended position. She has a right head tilt, drifts right, and has a left ear droop and no palpebral reflex on the left side but normal eye retraction when the eyelids are stimulated. Your anatomic diagnosis for this larger calf should be pons and medulla because of the depression, difficulty standing, and the neck extension. The left facial paralysis may be caused by the medial area lesion or an otitis media on the side. You should make a presumptive clinical diagnosis of an abscess or suppurative meningoencephalitis at this level that is an extension of an otitis media interna that may be bilateral. CSF should reflect this suppurative inflammation. This calf was euthanized, and autopsy showed bilateral suppurative otitis media interna and an abscess and meningitis on the left side of the pons and medulla. Case example 12-15 Signalment, 2-year-old female Hereford Holstein cross chief complaint, depression and head tilt history. This cow became depressed and developed a right head tilt approximately 10 days before this examination. She became progressively more depressed and, on occasion, continually walked in circles. Examination, see video 12-33. Note that this cow's sensorium borders on obtundation. Note also the right head tilt, the paresis of the right facial muscles, muscles of mastication, and tongue muscles. Anatomic diagnosis, pons and medulla, possibly diencephal on the degree of obtundation suggests the possibility of more than just a caudal brainstem disorder, and the dysfunction of the ascending reticular activating system may be at the level of the diencephal and add to the severity of the depression. Differential diagnosis, listeriosis, rabies, abscess, suppurative meningitis, thrombotic meningoencephalitis. The most common caudal brainstem disorder of adult cattle in the northeastern states is listeriosis. Listeriosis in a cow. Listeriosis is caused by the bacterium Listeria monocytogenes. Most affected cattle are over 1 year of age and exhibit various combinations of clinical signs of cranial nerve dysfunction. These signs include facial paralysis, tongue paresis, dysphagia, jaw paresis, and dysfunction of the central components of the vestibular system, along with clinical signs of UMN and GP system dysfunction and loss of their normal sensorium from involvement of their ascending reticular activating system. Some patients circle continually. This circling appears more as a propulsive circling than caused by a loss of balance with a vestibular system dysfunction. However, this circumstance is poorly correlated with a specific location of a lesion. Prosencephalic lesions are uncommon with listeriosis and yet are the most common cause of propulsive movements. The propulsive circling may possibly occur in these ruminants with listeriosis from involvement of the substantia nigra in the mesencephalon. The prominent caudal brainstem location of this disease reflects the likely route of entrance to the brain for this bacterium. The bacterium enters the body through abrasions and lacerations of the oral mucosa and gains access to the dendritic zones of general somatic afferent, GSA, neurons in the branches of the trigeminal nerve. The bacterium travels retrograde over these axons through the trigeminal ganglion and into the pons, where the fifth cranial nerve attaches to the brainstem. Inflammation occurs in these trigeminal nerve branches and in the caudal brainstem. Small foci of necrosis filled with neutrophils are scattered primarily through the pons and medulla. Adjacent to these necrotic foci is a non-suppurative inflammation that includes the meninges. The CSF usually reflects the non-suppurative component of the inflammation. Rigorous treatment with penicillin will usually improve or resolve the clinical signs in cattle that are still standing. The prognosis is less favorable in small ruminants. Recumbent animals have a poor prognosis regardless of the species. Be aware that this bacterium may affect humans. Therefore, you should wear at least protective gloves for this examination and administration of therapy. This organism thrives in poorly prepared silage, pH 5.5, and removal of this as a feed source may prevent affecting more animals on the same farm. We have never seen blindness in cattle with listeriosis or cattle with the anatomic diagnosis of a spinal cord location of listeriosis. The latter circumstance may be the result of the lack of lesions in the spinal cord or the masking of these lesions in the UMN and GP systems by the pons and medullary lesions that affect the same systems. See video 11-33 and case example 11-10 of a lamb with profound spinal cord lesions caused by listeriosis. Rabies is an unlikely clinical diagnosis because it generally causes recumbency in a few days and death by 7 to 10 days. An abscess or suppurative meningitis or both, secondary to otitis media interna, is more common in calves and is usually preceded by clinical signs of facial paralysis or peripheral vestibular system dysfunction. Thrombotic meningoencephalitis is caused by the bacterium Histophilus somni, Haemophilus somnus. This abnormality is a severe suppurativ vasculitis and associated parenchymal necrosis that usually causes a sudden onset of profound brainstem signs or just acute death. Thrombotic meningoencephalitis is an unlikely cause of the milder brainstem signs with cranial nerve deficits, as seen in the cow in this case example. Lesions may also occur in the prosencephalon and spinal cord. This disease is more common in feedlot cattle in the Midwestern states than dairy cattle in the Northeastern states. In the cow in this case example, CSF had 79 mg/dL of protein, normal, 40, and 31 WBCs mm3, all of which were mononuclear cells. Listeriosis was the presumptive clinical diagnosis. This cow was euthanized, and listeriosis was confirmed at autopsy. Case example 12-16 Signalment, 9-month-old male son and goat chief complaint, head tilt and abnormal gait history. 5 weeks before this examination, this buck was purchased from a goat herd in Washington State and shipped by air to upstate New York. For the past 3 to 4 weeks, this buck had shown progressive difficulty walking. Recently, he had fallen, with his head extended over his neck and his eyes twitching. Examination, see video 12-34. Note the right head tilt and abnormal vertical positional nystagmus, the left spastic hemiparesis and ataxia, and the episode of rolling induced by head and neck extension. Anatomic diagnosis, cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The left spastic hemiparesis and ataxia have resulted from UMN and GP system dysfunction on the left side of the pons and medulla. The history suggesting opisthotonus may be an indication of a rostral cerebellar, pons, or midbrain lesion. The right head tilt, abnormal nystagmus, and the rolling episode to the right indicate a possible paradoxical involvement of the central components of the vestibular system from a lesion in the left cerebellar peduncles or a lesion in the right vestibular nuclei. Differential diagnosis, listeriosis, caprine arthritis encephalitis, key, viral encephalitis, pyrrhelophistrongylus tenuis myosis, abscess, neoplasm listeriosis, key, and P. tenuis myosis are all common diseases of goats in the northeast, which can occur at this anatomic site. This goat came from a key-free herd in the state of Washington and had no serum antibodies for this viral agent. White-tailed deer are not indigenous to the state of Washington, and this goat had been in New York State for only 1 week before clinical signs were observed. This period is too short for this goat to have ingested an infected mollusk or the stage 3 larva of P. tenuis and to have developed neurologic signs. Experimentally, the earliest that clinical signs were observed after feeding large quantities of stage 3 larvae to sheep and goats was 11 days. The history reveals no sign of otitis media interna with neurologic abnormalities to suspect an intracranial extension of that suppurative lesion. In addition, no history of any illness was found to cause a bacteremia that might result in a brain abscess. Neoplasia is rare in goats, especially at this age. Medulloblastoma, primitive neuroectodermal tumor, occurs in the cerebellum of young calves. Listeriosis was considered the presumptive clinical diagnosis. CSF contained 35 mg/dL of protein, normal, 40, and 15 WBCs mm3, with 67% monocytes and 33% lymphocytes. Advanced imaging was not available at the time of this study. This buck was treated with antibiotics for 10 days but showed no improvement. He was euthanized, and autopsy showed a large well-encapsulated abscess centered in the left cerebellar peduncles and left cerebellar medulla, figure 12-30. No source of this focal infection was found. This lesion would have been evident on CT or MRI. Video 12-35 shows a 4-year-old castrated male pygmy goat, which was found one afternoon with a right head tilt encircling to his left. He was worse the next day when the examination scene in the video was made. Notice severe disorientation, his right head tilt, and a tendency to drift right. Also note that his gait shows only a vestibular ataxia, and note the difficulty with holding this goat stable while trying to evaluate the hopping responses. We concluded that the hopping responses in his right limbs were mildly slow. Note his abnormal resting nystagmus. The shift in the direction of the nystagmus with changes in the position of his head is not shown on the video. The anatomic diagnosis is right cerebellum, pons, and medulla. The differential diagnosis is the same as that in this case example. This animal is a New York State goat, where the white-tailed deer are plentiful. He is unlikely at this age. Listeriosis and miasis with a larva of P. tenuis are the most presumptive clinical diagnosis for this goat. Listeriosis is the more common cause of these brainstem signs. CSF contain 170 mg/dL of protein, normal, 40, and 312 WBCs mm3, with 52% neutrophils, 17% lymphocytes, 31% macrophages, and no eosinophils. This goat was euthanized, and an autopsy revealed a necrotizing meningoencephalitis associated with L-monocytogenes organisms. Congenital nystagmus. Congenital pendular resting nystagmus occurs in humans as an inherited abnormality or secondary to congenital lesions in the visual system of the infant, especially the retina, including ocular albinism. The nystagmus is usually pendular, that is, the eye movements are equal in velocity in both directions and it is very rapid. This nystagmus is benign and does not interfere with vision, given that the brain usually compensates for this presumably at the level of the cerebral cortex. A congenital rapid pendular nystagmus, which usually resolves spontaneously in a few weeks, occasionally occurs in one or more of a litter of puppies. The cause is unknown. In the 1970s, I studied a severe congenital nystagmus in an adult female Belgian shepherd, grown in Deal, and in three of her six offspring from one litter. In the United States, these dogs are called Belgian sheepdogs. This extreme nystagmus was pendular, which varied in rate but was usually quite rapid. No obvious visual deficiency was noted, and ocular examination was normal. On one occasion, a dog briefly held its head to one side as it was about to jump down from a table. No ataxia was evident. The head would occasionally oscillate with the nystagmus. Autopsy of the three litter mates revealed a complete lack of any optic chiasm. Figures 12-31 through 12-33. The optic nerve fibers continued into the ipsilateral optic tract uninterrupted and without any indication of decussation. Two of these dogs were 4 years of age at the time of autopsy, and their nystagmus had not changed. On the presumption that this malformation was an inherited disorder and at the request of a neuroscientist interested in what determines the crossing of axons at the optic chiasm, the owner repeated the mating that had produced these three affected dogs. This resulted in more actually asthmatic puppies with a pendular nystagmus, and numerous publications used. These studies established that the retina is relatively normal in these dogs and that the effect of the autosomal recessive inherited mutation is most likely exerted outside the retina. The use of these affected dogs in research evaluating corrective surgical procedures for humans continues today. In cattle, a congenital rapid fine pendular nystagmus is observed in many breeds and usually persists for the lifespans of these animals. It does not appear to interfere with vision. As a rule, the farmer is unaware of the nystagmus until a veterinarian observes it on an examination of the animal or when restraining an animal for routine blood testing. These cattle have normal extraocular muscle function and no indication of any vestibular system dysfunction. We are not aware of any structural abnormality in the visual system of these cattle, and they have no indication of any albinism. It is sporadic in occurrence, but a high incidence was seen in one Guernsey herd. The inheritance of this nystagmus is unknown. An examination of 2,932 cattle seen in 1 month by the ambulatory clinic at Cornell University revealed 15 animals with this pendular nystagmus. See video 12-36. This adult cow has congenital pendular nystagmus, also termed ocular tremors. Congenital pendular nystagmus has also been recognized sporadically in dogs with no recognized abnormality in their visual function. Congenital rapid fine pendular nystagmus is most often observed in cats with a varying degree of ocular albinism. An abnormality in the retinogenicular projections and the neuronal organization of the lateral geniculate nucleus has been observed in the Siamese cat and the white Persian tiger. More adrenal ganglion neurons projects their axons contralaterally in Siamese cats than the normally pigmented feline breeds. No obvious impairment of vision is noted. Many of these cats also have a mild strabismus. This congenital pendular nystagmus occurs in some cats and cattle with the Chaitya-Kagoshi syndrome, in which pigmentation and melanin granules are abnormal. Congenital pendular nystagmus may be a result of abnormal sensory input to the system that controls the eye movements related to vision. Some aberration of the architecture of the visual pathway may be a common factor in these patients. The albino cat exhibits excessive contralateral projection of optic nerve axons, and the Belgian shepherd shows complete lack of any contralateral projection.